Thank you. That was a loud one, right? So, okay, so we are going to do our next step, which is the national anthem. We would like to thank and recognize the talents of Martin Ortiz Luis, Steve Way Thomas, and Soul Power Productions. We thank them for sharing their talent with us. Please feel free to join in singing our national anthem. Please stand. Remember the students, staff, trustees, and family members of staff and trustees who have recently passed away, and keep them in our thoughts and prayers. Let's also remember the families of former Mayor Hazel McCarlin, who just passed away this Sunday. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord, and let the perpetual light shine upon them. May they rest in peace. Amen. I now ask trustee Paula. You lead us in prayer.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. O Almighty God, our Father in heaven, from whom all goodness and truth on earth have come forth, grant to us, the Catholic community gathered at this meeting, the vision to recognize and the vigor to espouse sound principles of educational theory and practice in a spirit of balanced judgment, and the proper perspective. Give us also the courage to turn always onto the path of higher goodness in our deliberations, administrative decisions, and courses of action. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I ask Susan Trustee Deas, please lead Atlanta class.
Dufferin Peel, as we know it today, is rich in the history and modern tradition of many First Nations. The Métis, the Inuit, the lands of the Anishinaabe to the Haudenosaunee and the Métis. These lands surrounding the Great Lakes are steeped in Indigenous territory. As we gather today on these treaty lands, our Catholic social teachings call us in solidarity with our Indigenous brothers and sisters to honor and respect the four directions: lands, waters, plants, animals, and ancestors that walk before us. All these wonderful elements of creation exist, gifted to us by our Creator God. We would like to acknowledge and thank the Mississaugas of the First New Credit First Nations for being stewards of this traditional territory.
Thank you, Student Trustee Dea. Next item is the approval of the agenda. Moved by Trustee Maria Pascucci. Could I have a seconder, please? By Trustee Brea Corbett. All in favor? Thank you. Any declaration of interest?
Chair.
Seven of
us. Thank you. I have a declaration of interest for A7, L1, L2, L3, M1A, M9A, M1B, M5A. I have a family member who was part of OECTA.
Could I have a mover to move the declared interest item to section L and M9? Moved by Trustee Anisha Thomas, seconded by Trustee Herman Villaria. All in favor? We have approval of minutes of the regular board meeting of December 13, 2022, less declared interest item.
Before we do that, Madam Chair, I'd like to point out something that needs to be fixed. Ambiguous, it's revoking the regulation, freezing.
Yes, it is. That was the report that we gave because it was the executive compensation was revoked at that time. It was frozen and then it was revoked and then it.
Through the chair, that's correct.
Yeah. So it's the revoking the regulation freezing, and it, maybe the one that we have to remove, and it should be the executive compensation. Because it would make revoking the regulation freezing the executive compensation to name a fee. So that's the correction, Cindy. Instead of and?
Yes. That makes it clear.
Thank you. Thank you, Trustee Gloria. So are we in that minute? We had it moved by. Oh, nobody moved it yet. Moved by Trustee Bruno Anika, seconded by Trustee Paula Mato Giovanazzi. All in favor? Carry. Thank you. And the approval of minutes of the special board meeting of January 17, 2020.
To the chair, less the declared item.
Oh, that's it. All right, thank you. So, Madam Director.
To the chair, good evening, and we're on section B, pastor's remarks. I'm pleased to present via video this evening, a presentation by Monsignor Shields. The theme this evening is called the Beatitudes.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, women and men of faith committed to Catholic education. We begin a new year of dedication to Catholic education, and I would like to introduce the theme of the Beatitudes this year. Why? Because the Beatitudes begin Jesus' time with his apostles. The Sermon on the Mount encompasses all the challenges of our daily Christian living. They are really a challenge to live the meaning of Jesus' words and how we integrate them into our lives and the lives of our students, teachers, parents, and staff of our schools. No one is perfect. But the challenge to do what is right is always there to lead us on the better relationships and care for our people. During this year, each month, I will focus on one beatitude to emphasize our need to live our lives as Jesus would want us to live. We all need encouragement and hope in life, and I believe the meaning of the Beatitudes will help motivate us in our Catholic lives and help others in the journey to the Lord. Pope Francis urges us to follow the Beatitudes as a roadmap of our Christian lives. The Beatitudes set the high standards of living our lives for others. And isn't that why we are here in this room tonight, to show our concerns and our responsibility to the students and teachers and parents in Catholic education? Your presence is a statement of your belief and faith and your deep desire to bring the Church's teaching to the forefront of Catholic education. And so, my friends, let us listen to this prayer and know that God embraces us in this moment of faith. We are reminded today that your blessings, O Lord, do not necessarily follow the logic of the world. The world believes that the rich are blessed, but Jesus reminds us it is poor who are blessed, the poor in spirit, and the materially poor as well. We pray for a more just world in which all have enough and none are left behind. Though we fear death and avoid its inevitable arrival, Jesus tells us that those who mourn are blessed. Help us to experience the truth of this mystery. Bring healing and wholeness to those who are sick, and comfort those of us who have lost loved ones. While people covet power, Jesus blesses the meek, instructs us. O God, in the ways of humility, help us to stand in solidarity with the oppressed and the marginalized. Show us your presence in the faces of those the world forgets. Give us a hunger and thirst for righteousness. Fill our hearts with love overflowing with mercy. Make our hearts pure and give us a vision of your glory. In a society divided by race and gender and class and ideologies, sexual orientation, and so many other labels we alone have created, remind us that we are created in your image, each of us a beautiful reflection of you, each of us your beloved child. Help us then to end our conflicts and wars. Help us to be peacemakers and agents of reconciliation. Gracious God, you have to so richly bless us with life, with love and joy, with hope in the midst of despair. Help us to be the salt of the earth. Help us to be the light of the world, sharing with others that which we have received, boldly proclaiming the good news of your love, finding the seeds of your kingdom within us and letting your way grow in our lives and through the world. Amen.
Madam Director, kindly convey our thanks to Monsignor Shields. Always, his homily is always wonderful, and it's very timely.
To the chair, I'd be pleased to do so.
Thank you, Madam Director. Next item.
Through the chair, we're now at section C, which is the awards and presentations, and this is wonderful news for our board this evening. The Ontario Catholic School Board Trustees Association short video contest. One of our schools and students from that school tied in a three-way tie for second place. And that school is St. Lorenzo Reus Catholic Elementary School. It was created by Evan Rubenstein, Carlos Arzino Espinoso, and Aiden Sol, and Kevin Jean. We're so pleased. I believe they're all here this evening, so that's exciting news. But we do want to share the video with you, and then there will be an opportunity for you, Chair, to call them up with their families, who I'm sure are very proud, to take a picture with the Chair and the Vice Chair, who is also the trustee for that area.
Hello, my name is Evan, and these are my friends, Aiden, Carlos, and Kevin. We are here to talk about our Catholic values and how we show that as a community in our school, San Lorenzo Ruiz.
The video will give you insight on how a Catholic community represents and shows its values.
During September, we remember Terry Fox's achievement by running or walking around our school. We also learn about Terry Fox running for cancer research and his courage to run from Newfoundland to Thunder Bay. This teaches us to have courage and bravery, and hopefully make a difference in the community.
During October, we participate in a food drive to donate food to people in need who don't have food. In November, we participate in the Dr. Simone Candy Drive to donate candy to children to help them produce gastric fluids and saliva. This is an opportunity for us as a Catholic community to show our generosity towards others.
During December, we participate in a Catholic event called the Angel Tree. It is a Christmas fundraiser where we donate gifts to children and families. We encourage students and the Catholic community to be part of this fundraiser. This is an opportunity to demonstrate generosity.
In our school, we participate in an anti-bullying awareness event by wearing pink shirts. We learn and discuss bullying at school so we don't do it to others. This is an opportunity for us as a Catholic community to demonstrate acts of kindness towards others.
We participate in Share Life in San Lorenzo Ruiz. Each person in every class donates a toonie for Share Life to help those in need who don't have money, food, or resources. This is an opportunity for us as a Catholic community to learn and become good citizens and role models.
Here at San Lorenzo Ruiz, we show our generosity and care to those around us. The events we participate in may seem like a small act of kindness, but in reality, they make a big difference in our community, but also the world. When we help others, it shines a light of positivity towards them, but also to us. At the end of the day, we're all human beings and we should look out for each other. I hope this video gave you insight into how we show our Catholic values in the school.
I just want to welcome Principal David Flipper, the principal of San Lorenzo Ruiz, and the teacher that worked with the students, Madame Dani Balis. I get that right. And could I call on the four students as well? Ivan, Kevin, Carlos, and Aiden. Trustee Thomas Thomas, would you like to say something?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Congratulations to the principal, David Clifford, and the teacher, and all students and families, the parents, especially the parents. They contributed time and support for these students to come forward and bring such a wonderful video. I'd like to congratulate all the school community, as well as this is a congratulation from trustees from Dufferin Peel and the community of Dufferin Peel Catholic School Board. Thank you.
Thank you.
Through the chair, we are now moving to Section D, which dealt with delegations. And before we call the first delegation forward, I know that the chair wanted to read the conditions around the delegation to all delegations.
Thank you. May I ask all the delegation to please stand? What I'm going to do is I'm going to read the rules and the guidelines as you delegate. So kindly listen. So welcome and thank you for your delegation to the regular board meeting of the Board of Trustees. I will review a few points related to the rules and process related to delegations. You will have 5 minutes to make your presentation. Each of you will have 5 minutes. This will be timed. Vice Chair Trustee Thomas will signal when there is only 1 minute left. He will raise his hand when there's only 1 minute left. If you intend to use or begin to use the name, title, position of a staff member or members, or any personal or other information with respect to a member of the board or committee or a pupil or his or her parent or guardian, I will rule that you must address the committee or board of trustees in an in-camera session. Delegates can be critical of the board decisions or make submissions with respect to a recommendation or decision. However, delegates should refrain from negative, critical, or derogatory comments about any identifiable person. Once you have completed your presentation, trustees will be given an opportunity to ask you questions of clarification related to your presentation. Once questions of clarification from trustees are completed, your role in the delegation will be concluded and you will be asked to leave the podium and take your seat in the gallery. At that point, trustees may debate the issue and may ask questions of staff. It is important to be aware that no decision will be made on the issue at this meeting. If there are no questions, I will start with the first delegation, which is the Respect Life Week, Yara Basturi and Genevieve Parson, the Right to Life, Mississauga Brampton. I will call each delegation as we're done. Go ahead, then. Five minutes. There's no, you have to turn on the microphone, please. Okay, ready? Good. So my name is Genevieve Carson, and I was going to give you a brief little greeting from our current president, Yolanta Galaska, who is too sick to come tonight, but given the time constraint, we really did think we had a few more minutes than five, and I don't want to stress out our key presenter tonight, Yara, who's our youth representative. So without further ado, Yara.
Good evening, everyone. I wanted to take the opportunity to thank everyone for letting us be here today and present our piece and why we're here. My name is Yara Bashuri, and I'm a grade 12 student at St. Louis, Wisconsin, a secondary school in Mississauga, as well as the youth liaison for Mississauga and Area Right to Life, and I'm joined today by a few of my colleagues. So who we are, just a show of hands, how many people have heard of Mississauga and Area Right to Life? No, okay, no worries. So we're a local grassroots educational arm of the pro-life movement in Mississauga and Brampton. We work together with parishes and schools, the school boards, our communities, and our churches to educate all of our stakeholders on the truths about abortion and euthanasia and the repercussions on victims and all of society. And we're also an organization recognized by the Archdiocese of Toronto as one of lay faithful. And there's our board up there. So why we're here, as I'm sure you know, COVID has had a devastating impact on our efforts to engage with our youth. And every day we're at risk of being further socialized away from a culture of life. As we've been told, you know, we have evidence from our stakeholders, including parents, teachers, chaplains, and youth like myself. We need your help to bring attention to the need to refocus youth on gospel of life issues. And we need the board and trustees' help to help restore awareness of critical life issues in our schools and to our youth. So the current state, as we know, the pro-life movement has fallen off the radar screen for our youth. And we've had a hardening of student attitudes towards life issues in the past 2 years throughout the pandemic. And you can see right there from a grade 8 class, kind of major issues in the world right now, and it's missing the right to life. So quite sad for it to be missing there. And so in order to deal with the problem, we had a brainstorming session last February with many community leaders in the pro-life cause, including teachers, chaplains, and so on and so forth. And this is some feedback they gave us on how we could engage with this issue. First of all, improving knowledge and messaging with sound pro-life apologetics, mentoring pro-life advocates, participating in the March for Life in Ottawa every year, providing inclusive and safe spaces for pro-life students, devising pro-life action-based ministries, and overcoming political roadblocks and the need to seek out allies for pro-life education. So planned projects to tackle this, we wanted to initiate a Respect Life Week in schools aligned with the March for Life in Ottawa, which is in May, aligned with the Catholic Church's catechism as well as our Catholic graduate expectations. Provide pro-life flags and plaques in schools as a visible symbol of advocacy, reinvigorating the support and engagement of school chaplains and teachers on promoting life issues in our schools and during the March for Life in Ottawa, education sessions and resources to help students understand and articulate pro-life issues through a faith and humanity perspective, and direct student advocacy through a TED Talk style contest on pro-life issues. So our desired outcomes is, like I just mentioned, to have the Respect Life Week, the pro-life flag, and the plaque installed, to go to the March for Life in Ottawa, which we'd be more than happy to help subsidize, a TikTok style contest, as well as support from our trustees for our plans in working with local schools. We're there to offer our full support however the board may need. So the next steps is to, as I said, to coordinate with teachers and chaplain team leaders to institute Respect Life Week. We're prepared to help with prayers and materials to organize that, ordering flags and plaques. We're also prepared to subsidize that for schools, working with schools on sending students to the March for Life in Ottawa like it was pre-COVID and bouncing back now post-pandemic, and launching a TED Talk contest and a qualification process for students to participate in. So the pro-life flag, just quickly, I'm gonna have my colleague Timothy here explain to you what it means and the meaning behind the flag.
All simple, the design of the pro-life flag is highly symbolic of the pro-life message. It stresses love them both. Pro-life flag provides a unifying symbol for a powerful pro-life movement with a shared goal. Through a public design contest and a movement-wide vote in July of 2021, it was this flag that was chosen. The design was created by Brazilian pro-life designer Nanda Gasparini. The white background symbolizes nonviolence in the womb as well as the innocence of the unborn child. Two baby feet represent the humanity of the unborn child. Baby feet have been a symbol associated with the pro-life movement since they find the international pro-life symbol in 1970. The two pink hands represent the pregnant mother, holding and protecting her child. The circle shape formed by the hands evoke imagery of a pregnant mother's growing child. Safe, pure, protected place for developing. The white heart in between the feet symbolizes the pro-life movement's love for both the mother and the two stripes again emphasize the two distinct human lives present in a pregnancy. The stripes also form an equal sign, stressing that the unborn child is equally and fully human and therefore deserving equal human rights. The stripes can also represent the role of both the father and mother in creating and raising. colors blue and pink mean different things. Additionally, they have been colored different colors associated with the also reemphasize two lives present, mother and child. Finally, the pro-life flag is also meant to represent. We are looking to get the pro-life flag for a visible reminder of the movement and the life.
Is that the end of your presentation?
Thank you. And any questions you have, we're open to answering.
Yes. Thank you. Are there any questions from trustees of clarification? Trustee Bruno Ayinica?
Love when we get to speak after the Mass is at church to promote different things, whether it's the life chain in the fall or 40 Days for Life or the March for Life. So it just depends on the pastor. And certainly we did that before COVID. We were invited to several churches to do that. And we've got priests who are on board with getting the pro-life flag made visible in the churches too. So that's our goal. That's one of our goals. Yeah, we have spoken to several youth groups in the churches pre-pandemic, and we love doing that, and we're hoping that we get, a lot of the youth groups have shrunken inside, and so we're hoping that we get to do that again.
Thank you. Trustee Paula Meadow-Gibonazzi.
Hi, I represent Dufferin Caledon, and I was wondering if you guys have any representation in our area.
I used to give talks at Robert Hall years ago, and Birthright, and so, and now we have Monsignor who's out in Wildfield, I think, so we talk to him, and we're hoping to establish. I'm a teacher, I teach in the Orangeville schools too, so.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah.
So. Okay. So I want to thank you both, thank you all for what you're doing, I really appreciate it.
We really rushed, we had a little bit more time.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions from the trustees? Questions of clarification? Trustee Bria Corbett.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and through you. Just in your delegation form, you had indicated learning opportunities for our high school students. Just wondering if you could elaborate on that, what you had envisioned for the students in terms of extension of curriculum.
So in the past, we've been able to work with the school board in doing a couple of youth symposiums, which we loved doing, and we thought they went very well. We did student surveys beforehand, determining where the kids stood on the issue. In this case, it was abortion, and incredible change by the end when they did the post-symposium survey. We worked with Toronto Right to Life. They came a much younger breed than I am, and they gave great talks on the life issues. We had representation from the Sisters of Life, from Birthright, two really good, and then we did one on euthanasia as well. So we are so interested in helping out with that again. Man always did a great job of putting on those educational things before the kids went to the march. And so if we could work with her, we are a couple of teachers on our board, and we'd love to do that. That's one option. Then we just, we really rely on the people from Toronto Right to Life who are board approved, who come out and give talks. And they are so happy to come and be, if they're invited individually by schools to do that, we would subsidize their way out here and them giving the talks. They just do a great job. So if we can do that again, we'd be loved.
Thank you. And just in follow-up, I'm wondering, have you had any involvement in terms of, instead of large group assemblies and that type of thing, in terms of individual classes in schools, like parenting class, I know is a great opportunity where they really get, it would align well with that curriculum when they are talking about caring for the child, caring for the newborn. Has that opportunity been available?
We've done that before. We've gone into parenting classes. I remember doing it Cardinal Leje, what other schools do we do it for? We were invited there every semester to do that. And would, again, love to do that too. It can be tailored to, it can be, you know, these speakers are so well formed that they can do it from a, to a law class if they were talking about the law, or parenting, like you said, or science, you know. And not just abortion, but euthanasia as well. These are things that they are trained and willing to do. And they make an impact. You know, they're younger and they're very tech savvy and they do a great job. So it's just a matter of being invited out, and we would love to make that happen. So if a teacher wants to come, we've let the teachers and the religion department heads know that we're available to arrange those speakers, and we could pay their honorariums and do that. So yes, I think that's helpful to do it in a small class as well. Right. And we didn't ever present to like a whole school, but kids that were participating in the march would be bused to a central place. So there was about 200 students in that event. We had the Cardinal out for the one on euthanasia. It was great.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank
you. Are there any questions of clarification from the...
Our expectation is just to get some presence for the symbolism. We're not necessarily bent on having it blown at the top of the mast on the highest mountain. But if we can introduce them softly into our schools as a rallying point, could be in the chaplain's area, could be in the chapel, along with the plaque, which goes into the background, give some more detail as to what it's all about. If we can get presence, that's what our objective is. We don't need to get omnipresent. We're aware of the policy. Yeah.
Thank you. That's the question of clarifications from the trustees. Thank you so much. Thank you. Are there any questions from the trustees to the staff? Trustee Ainika?
Through the chair, Trustee Ainika, I don't know if your mic is on, and so anybody watching online wouldn't be able to hear you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Where do we go from here?
Through the chair, staff would be very pleased to collaborate with Right to Life to with all the suggestions that they had in their presentation this evening. So I will have Superintendent Carmel Murphy, and we also have Deacon Ray here this evening, connect with them directly to start working on preparations for that week of focus. We can also look at obtaining the flags, et cetera. So we would be very pleased to collaborate with you.
Because March is just around the corner, Madam Chair. That you know, and of course, heads up could be given to our principals that this is coming down the road. It would be heads up per se, even though staff members are going to be reaching out and working.
Through the chair, trustees would be aware that I have webcasts with the leadership team immediate following board meetings. That's scheduled for tomorrow afternoon. This will be on the agenda.
Perfect. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Just a correction, it's in May. They're looking for the week in May, which is the March for Life is in May. March for Life. Yes, I got that. Yes, thank you. Are there any questions to the staff?
Thank you, Madam Chair. And through you, a couple questions with regards to the specific week that they were looking at in May. I know we do have Catholic Education Week beginning the end of April into the first week of May. So if possible, to avoid that week.
We know that Catholic Education Week is the first week in May. Can someone remind me what the request is for the focus on the Right to Life? the week that they're focused?
They're requesting to have a Respect Life Week. And the March to Life is on May 11th. Did I get that right?
Through the chair. So there would be no conflict with Catholic Education Week. So we can work with that.
Thank you. Just wanted a heads up on that. And through the chair, regarding the flag, has it been approved by the Archdiocese of Toronto? The archbishops, have they had input?
Through the chair, Deacon Ray can respond to that request.
There we go. Magic. Thank you, Brian. Through the chair, I did connect with the liaison of it for education, Barry White, the Archdiocese, and the Archdiocese would have no problem flying it in the within the school, not obviously on the flagpole outside and as much as they mentioned about making it visible indoors.
Thank you. Thank you. Are there any other questions to the staff? Being none, so we all know where we're going after this. Madam Director?
Through the chair, the second delegation is in regards to violent sports, and we're pleased to welcome Father DeMont to the podium to delegate.
I hope you will be able to hear me properly with my French accent. Sometime you can't. Are you okay? I would like us to watch a video. I hope this is not part of my 5 minutes.
It's part of your 5 minutes.
The video is 45 seconds.
45
seconds?
I want
this to be part of my 5 minutes, please.
Oh, you don't want it to be part of the...
No, it's just to put us in, instead of you saying anything, the video.
Okay, so that's all part of 5 minutes.
I would like that not to be just the video, and then my 5 minutes follows.
I'm sorry, but that's part of your presentation. So anything that you will present to us.
Well, okay, I will have to speak fast then, and I'm very sorry to hear that.
Yes, it's all part of the whole package of 5 minutes.
Thank you.
Thank you. So do you want to start with a video, or do you want to start speaking, because we're going to time?
Do the video, please. I think it will put us into what we want to.
Okay, so as soon as the video goes up, we're going to start the timer.
Tonight on Frontline, the epic story of football's concussion crisis. These players come down with dementia and then Alzheimer's, and then they're gone. A major frontline investigation of what the NFL knew and when it knew it.
The level of denial was just profound.
We strongly deny those allegations that we withheld any information or misled the players.
We don't know who is at risk for it. We don't know if concussion in and of itself is what causes the abnormalities.
A decades-long battle between scientists, players, and the nation's most powerful sports league.
You can't go against the NFL. They'll squash you.
Next, League of Denial, the NFL's concussion crisis.
I'm really wondering if every single football player doesn't have.
Yes, a dear friend of mine asked me, Michelle, what was so special about Hazel McCallion? As we all know about her and what she stood for in this neck of the wood. Now, I said to him, of course, with all she accomplished, Hazel was never afraid to speak her truth. Now, the reason I'm bringing her memory today, and may she rest in peace indeed, is because to speak our truth is so important, especially for our youth who are listening to us. Those youth who are living in such a contradictory world at times. As a priest, I always thought that our Catholic school system should be somehow different from the public school system. If it is not, why have one at all? We all know there are many voices out there who would like to dispense with the Catholic school system in Ontario. Now, personally, I know that, yes, there are wonderful things going on, especially in this board, and I congratulate you. For example, in the board I was at, we didn't have any chaplain for full-time in the schools, and here you do, so I say to you, bravo. But it is not sufficient to have voices. We all know that, especially for the children, action speaks a lot louder than any words we can say. With this in mind, then, I recognize the fact that Tony Whelan, who brought this very important topic on, as a Catholic chaplain, he always tried to speak truth and be a living witness to the youth as to how we should strive to live, not just as general human values, but above all as Christian Catholic values. And we heard some in the previous delegation today. But if we do, it will often mean that we will have to be different and remember that we're all called to be prophets in our society. I say this because when we were baptized, and I baptized many people over 35 years, I remember always when I did the anointing, God the Father anoints you with a chrism of salvation. As Christ was anointed priest, prophet, and king, so may you live always as member of his body. So this is an important part of our mission as baptized Catholics, to be prophets. In the past few weeks, Father Richard Rohr, many of you may know him, he's a Franciscan who has daily devotion on the web. He said, one of the gifts of the prophet is that they are not afraid to evoke a crisis where one did not appear to exist before their truth-telling. Is Tony a prophet? In one way, I think he is on the subject we are dealing with today. I understand he has brought this to the board numerous times, and I'm confused as to why the answer he gets sometimes is like, the reason we cannot take action is because we take our direction from the Ministry of Education. And so if we are going to teach our children a radical reverence for life, how can we give an answer like that when we all know that football kills? It is not my conclusion about that sport. We saw part of a documentary that was made in The Star in 2013, an article that was titled Football Kills and Nobody Cares, Do We? And in The Globe, once there was a title that was, okay, we get it, football kills. Now, what time is the game on? There's no doubt in my mind that we should not continue to encourage violent and destructive sports. And we should all take our direction from our faith leader, not a provincial ministry. I say this because you may not know this. In 2018, the Christian's Perspective on Sports was written by the church in Rome, and they had they have something that they wrote. They said, in case where we are only recently learning about the harmful effects of a particular sport to the body, including damage to the brain, it is important to make decisions regarding these sports that place the dignity of the human person and their well-being first. Now, this is not Father Michel or Tony or any one of these dedications' creed. It is the church speaking from where we should take our direction. And so I'd like to end by quoting Father Rohr again when he says, the prophet's job is first to deconstruct current illusion, which is the status quo, and then reconstruct a new and honest foundation.
Father, 5 minutes is up. You want to just finish that sentence or that paragraph?
I just said I started by saying we want to speak truth. What kind of truth are we going to speak?
Thank you. Thank you. Are there any questions to questions of clarifications to Father? No?
Dear
no,
as,
Father?
Dear as mud.
No questions, Father. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Are there any questions to the staff? Trustee Maria Pascucci?
Through you, Chair, to staff. We're hearing a number of individuals tonight. I'd just like to ask if we can get, I know this issue has been dealt with in the past. I'd like to recognize that we bring things forward relative to this topic. I just want to say that as an umbrella presentation because we're talking on this number. I want to say this six times, but if we can see what we have, looking forward to the next board, committee meeting. If I can request, that'd be appreciated. Madam Director, would next one be okay, or would it be the one after that?
Through the Chair, we can bring it to the February Faith and Program Committee meeting.
Fair enough, ma'am. you, Madam Chair.
Trustee Bruno-Enica.
But these people.
Through the chair, for clarity, the request was to bring a report forward to faith and program. And just a reminder to Trustee Ainika, you need to turn on your mic when you're speaking.
Trustee Mario Pascucci.
Bruno, thank you very much. It's an intention to listen. It's an intention to listen to all seven presentations, and thank you for bringing that up. It's critical that we address issues that are of concern to a number of people. Yes, thank you very much. Yes, I look forward to hearing.
Thank you. Are there any other questions to the staff? Seeing none, could we have the Madam Director, our next presenter?
Through the chair, we're pleased to welcome to the podium Angela Cecchi. Angela, help me.
Joseph?
I believe Angela withdrew. Delegate. Number three has withdrawn.
So you're delegate number five then, because it should be Tony Whelan as delegate number four.
Delegate number four.
It's Tony in our agenda.
Yeah. We're gonna all go. So.
Okay, fair enough. So we're now at,
okay, we're just
D5 on the agenda, and
the reason we're following this agenda is we have a copy of your presentation, so that's why we're trying to do that. So give us a little bit minute so the trustees can look for your presentation. So that will be on page 44. The top sheet. Is it Joseph? Joseph Cunyari?
Correct.
Joseph Cunyari?
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we're going to allow for you not to follow the agenda. This is just a concern from the trustees. So we're here now. We're going to allow it for now.
We appreciate your time.
So the next item, we will follow the same process for the agenda. Thank you. Okay, are you ready to start?
Yes, thank you.
You're ready?
The politics of normalizing violence. End violent sports in Catholic schools now. The belly of the beast is never satisfied. We live in a world that spends over $2 trillion on military weapons. We live in a world in which 25,000 people die every single day due to hunger. We live in a world in which roughly 1 in 3 women have been subjected to physical and or sexual gender-based violence. We live in a culture of violence in which the reverence for life has virtually disappeared. Live in a culture of violence in which sport commentators go down in history for so-called catchphrases, such as, boom, goes the dynamite. It's an A-bomb for A-Rod. And let's get ready to rumble. Moments before adult men in our society strike each other with blows to the body and head, which are often described in slow motion playback as beautiful, crisp, accurate, and glorious. We live in a culture of violence in which the dominant discourse of waiting all day for Sunday night football overshadows concerns linked to brain injuries, among other fatalities in violent sports for people of all ages. Although sports media hype conceals the negotiations in merchandise, licensing, and TV contracts, which generate billions of dollars in revenues through the instrumentalization of violence. We live in a culture of violence in which companies such as Nike Football mainstream myths about so-called player protection, all while the Athletic Equipment Managers Association states that even a helmet that meets standards doesn't prevent concussions. And this often falls upon hardened hearts and deaf ears. We live in a culture of violence that arms children in the so-called third world and labels them child soldiers, all while arming 16 and 17-year-olds in secondary schools with C7 and C9 rifles under the rubric of cooperative education. Did I mention the dangling carrot of 4 credits as well as pay? Needless to say, when it comes to the recruitment of youth into militaristic structures, such as violent sports or the military itself, we're expected to turn a blind eye and play shy while people get injured, traumatized, and die. We live in a culture of violence that names every form of addiction except for our addiction to violence. We live in a culture of violence that exploits various forms of labor as a means of commodifying bombs, rape, tackles, and punches to the head as pure spectacle. In such a culture, violence is perpetually rationalized and instrumentalized as a means of attaining some type of reward. For instance, cold cash, bonuses, trophies, rings, stardom, status, and so much more. That is the signs and symptoms of an impoverished people and culture. We live in a culture of violence in which the violent sport industry propagates ideas linked to teamwork, dedication, and love of the game as a means of concealing a deeply rooted issue ingrained in the mentality of sport. Toxic masculinity. That is a form of masculinity that teaches young boys to replace human vulnerability with aggression and dominance. We live in a culture of violence that employs a number of political maneuvers as a means of self-preservation. For instance, the politics of rules and regulations reduce the issue of a culture of violence to one of reporting procedures and risk management. Politics of this sort conceal political interests as well as the uneven distribution of mental, physical, and spiritual consequences intimately linked to the position that one occupies within the hierarchy of competitive contact sports. For instance, owners, administrators, coaches versus frontline players. At the end of the day, who exactly gets knocked out? In a culture of violence, sports, video games, movies, comic books, and foreign policy come to reflect and reproduce the myth of redemptive violence. Similar to the prevailing neoliberal ideology of the day, the myth of redemptive violence indoctrinates us into the worldview that life is competition and combat. Peace is achieved through war and security through strength. In closing, we have clear alternatives, one of which involves the application of Jesus's call to a radical way of life called nonviolence. Anything less comprises complicity in a culture of violence. We can continue to feed the belly of the beast, or we can intensify our faith and take a small yet significant step towards ending a culture of violence by putting an end to violent sports in Catholic schools. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any questions or clarification to the delegate? No questions. Thank you very much for your presentation.
Thank you.
Are there any questions to the staff? Are there any questions to the staff? Thank you. Madam Director?
Through the chair, D4, Violent Sports, I'm pleased to welcome Tony Whelan to the podium to delegate.
Well, we do have an agenda to follow. I do not understand why it's being changed right now. Trustee Mary Pascucci. Excuse me, you are not in order. Are there any trustees who would like to speak to this one? Trustee Stefano Pascucci.
Chair, I also agree with Trustee Mario Pascucci. We have an agenda. It's set up.
And
well,
if
a misunderstanding.
Excuse me, you don't have the, you do not have the floor. And please also speak to the chair if you don't mind. The chair, I don't believe that this that we should be changing the agenda because we've approved the agenda. Thank you.
No problem.
Yes, I think we should follow our agenda. The next speaker is
The chair is Tony Whelan.
Tony Whelan, are you ready to start? Thank you.
Your point that this was dealt with already. This is a large point in my delegation. 2017, I did a delegation report. I asked this question. Are the benefits of these games worth the cost of team life? Are they worth the chance of losing team life? Are the benefits worth the cost of many teams developing a chronic chance?
You make sure your microphone is on or speak closer to the microphone. Thank you.
So this nuance of taking the chance is related to the concept of burden of proof. Malcolm Gladwell did a podcast on it. Ross is going to be talking about burden of proof. Really important point. Anyway, I said at that time, can we please invest the time and resources needed to discern this very important issue? I was told that there would be a report. Hoped it would be a report dealing with the moral issue raised. Later that year, I read this headline in the paper. Here are the sports with the most reported head injuries this year in Dufferin Field. I would count it. The report was in no way a discernment of the ethical issue raised. Didn't deal with it at all. You may wonder why I keep coming back. It's because you haven't answered the question. And I believe we could. Like I can't believe that we couldn't deal with this. The presenting issue is violent sports that hurt kids. The deeper issue is our lack of capacity to really get into this issue and give a reasonable response. An example is the board's response quoted in the Catholic Register in September. He said it is a voluntary activity. It will inform parents of the dangers, give the parents the choice. But we are not neutral in allowing them the choice. We're organizing and encouraging it in our schools. Encouraging it. This is a very important point. You cannot be neutral. One of my many conversations with board administration, I was asked, can we know the answer? I got up, I was in the chapel on a Teams meeting. I went into my office and I got Laudato Si, the environment. Before the Pope can deal with the important issue of the environment, he has to establish that there is such a thing as right and wrong. He quotes Pope Benedict. To quote, all social and environmental destruction is ultimately due to the same evil. The notion that there are no indisputable truths to guide our lives, and hence human freedom. There are indisputable truths. Reverence for life. The dignity of the person. The Vatican reference. The most important guiding principle is whether it is good for our students. We want them to have a good life. It's our North Star. Well-being, exceptional lives. Would you agree? Let me give you an example of someone with the right sense of direction. There's a coach in my school who played and loves football. He says he stopped coaching because he had to call the ambulance 3 times in one season. He also stopped because he realized he would not want his own son to play. This reminds me of Don Bosco, whose feast day it is today, patron saint of youth and education. He famously said that we should treat the boys as if they were our very own. This is passion for the well-being of our kids. That's our North Star. So I don't think this is a complicated issue. we've managed to make it complicated with all kinds of unsound arguments. I'm going to give you a handout with a list of 34 that I've heard. People say things like, you know, they pray before they go out there. Well, they're still getting hurt. They don't mean to hurt each other. They're still hurting each other. Not doing the work of discernment, really listening, church teaching, scripture, science. Fratelli Tutti calls us to a different kind of politics. It says this, together we can seek the truth in dialogue. In relaxed conversation or in passionate debate. To do so calls for perseverance, periods of silence, focus, penetrate to the heart of the matter. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any questions of the delegate? Clarification? Trustee Herman Beloria.
Madam Chair, through you and Tony, Tony, which sport that we currently have running in Dufferin Field would you classify as violent?
Thank you for your question. I've always emphasized rugby and football. You know, people, they say you'd had to get rid of all sports. That's one of the 34 on the list. 34, I think, are unreasonable arguments. You had to get rid of all sports. I've heard it many times. Where would you draw the line? And I say, let's draw the line where students, young people are getting killed. Excuse me one second. Could you bring me that? So you guys know about Wesley Jordan.
Have to be on the microphone because we have people listening on.
Anyway, I've emphasized rugby and football. It's about in football in the United States, a lot of kids play about 2 a week. I don't think other sports. Boxing, like, it's madness. Now, we don't have boxing. But like, it drives me nuts to think. Jeanette Zapata, 2021 in Montreal, was a boxing fight. People gathered to watch. And she took a number of blows. She's an 18-year-old from Mexico. She fell to the floor, convulsions. This was on a Saturday. By Thursday, she passed away. So these people gathered. They watch two people pummel each other in the face and watch somebody get killed, knowing that it could happen, because it's happened many times before. You know, you can be in a restaurant and up on TV is mixed martial arts. It was illegal in Ontario up to 2000. You know, they said it would bring revenue, so they said, oh, yeah, okay, let's have it. Pummeling each other in the face, blood. Ridiculous. So when there's fights in our schools, there was one at your time. I've seen this on the news, right, about fights in schools. And the kids gather and cheer and take out their phones. I spoke to one last week, and I said, like, why do you cheer? And he said, it's entertaining. I don't even blame the kid. This is our culture. This is what Joseph was talking about, our culture of violence.
Did it answer Tony, your question already?
Did you answer my question? You didn't answer my question.
I would say rugby and football are the two worst. And And from there, you might want to start looking at concussion hockey as well. And you know, the thing is, you know, when Damar Hamlin almost died, right, and there was articles about this, and should we be watching football? Can I take 1 minute for this? Yeah, I understand.
Thank you.
So I'd say rugby.
Please answer the question.
Okay. I'd say rugby and football are the two deadliest.
And a follow-up question. So the conclusion to this presentation is, would I be correct in saying that you would want us, you would want the board not to run football or rugby?
Yes. And I would also, like, for instance, the last delegation that I did.
That's yes.
Yes. Yes.
Mr. Rowland,
also,
you please stay answering the question.
Okay.
It's a question of clarification only, please. Thank you.
Yes, that's where I'd like it to go, but I would be totally open to, if there were a couple of you willing to work with a couple of us, the bishop said, can I finish by sentence? Yes, I'm answering the question. So as far as what I would like, if not that, at the very least, a committee, a couple of you who are willing to work with a couple of us, the leader of the parent council, Mr. Yes. Kanabi, he said that he would work with us. So in answer to your question, it's I would say yes, or at the very least, a committee to look at it.
Well, but the point of that committee would be, let's say we have a committee, and let's say that it can work very fast, but would you say then that by September next year, that there will be no football or rugby running?
I can't say how long it would take.
But that is the intent.
Pardon me?
That is the intent.
Whether we would
it
have
happens
to
next year or the following year, the intent is not to run football or rugby. Maybe.
Well, if that's the conclusion that the committee comes to.
Yes or no?
Yes.
Are you done, Trustee Gloria? Thank you. Trustee Anisha Thomas, please.
Through the chair. All sports have risks. Students seek permission to be a part of these sports with parental consent. So again, I want you to clarify, all sports have risks. So why are you singling out these two sports that when other sports have the potential to be dangerous and risky as well?
Well, I guess it just shocked me when I saw the news, Manny Castillo, Rowan Stringer, when I see these people killed. And like, so I didn't go looking for this. I just noticed it in the news, right? And then Rowan Stringer, Brody McCarthy and PEI, like I just happened to be watching a hockey game and Don Cherry said, about this young person at PEI. And I go looking for hockey deaths. Because people say, oh, what about hockey? And I can't even find them. Whereas these ones in football, I'm sure you know that it's all over the news. The reference, like it was just in the news last week when Damar Hamlin, and there's a Jesuit magazine called America, and the headline said, you know, why are we watching this viciousness? Now, I don't worry about professionals, adults watching it, but I'm talking about young people and young people in schools in particular. This article here that was in the American Journal of Bioethics called Medical Ethics and School Football. So in schools, it's particularly problematic. This is a really well reasoned, like in the American Journal of Bioethics, about why it shouldn't be in schools. We can't change the world, the madness of violence and the culture. Well, maybe we can. Maybe we can do our small part to say that we can be different. That headline that said football kills and nobody really cares. What if we were to rewrite that headline, football kills, and we found somebody that wants to make a difference?
I think you answered the question, Trustee Anisha. Thank you. Next speaker on the list, Trustee Paula D'Amato-Givanazzi.
Hello, thank you, Mr. William, for your presentation. My question to you is, how many times have you guys presented here at the Dufferin Peel Catholic District School Board?
I have a handout for you on that. I meant to give before I presented, and three other times. And here's the thing, like I just said, the question hasn't been answered yet. Imagine counting how many concussions, but the question was, do the benefits outweigh the risks? And this is a deep ethical issue.
Well, thank you, Mr. Whelan. I'll tell you, I've done my own research on brain injuries, and you're 100% right. And I know that ping pong is the safest sport. Thank you so much.
Next, Trustee Stefano Pascucci, please.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you very much for your presentation. Couple questions. To follow up on Trustee Valoria's question, if you want to stop football, we stop it in Dufferin Peel. What's to stop a child from going from here to the co-terminus board? Nothing.
Nothing.
Exactly. Yep. So the next question then would be, have you brought this to the ministry's eyes? Because
yes,
it
yes,
would
I
have to be a full provincial ban in order for this to stop happening.
Well, I disagree with that. I'd like to see one board be a leader. Let me give you an example. When they got rid of the strap in Ontario, it started with one board, Toronto in 1970. There was a trustee, didn't want to use the strap anymore. And well, this does answer the question. It started with one board. The rest of the country caught up 35 years later. So one board being a leader, and I think this is on task, is something that we could look for. But again, to your question, I spoke to the minister in charge of school safety. And she said to me, they already accuse us of being a nanny state. That's what I expected from the government. They worry about votes and they don't want to look like that. And I would expect different here. We're talking about young people getting a brain disease and even dying on the field over and over and over again. I know that if in my activity, even if it was voluntary and I had parent permission, and I was continually calling the ambulance, and then somebody died, I wouldn't continue with the sport.
Okay, so then back to my other question. If we were to stop this, what would stop students from going to the co-terminus?
From going to the other board?
Right across the street.
Yeah.
Because they would have the sport, we would not.
Let me see.
And then if you start at football, you go to hockey. You go to hockey, you go to soccer, you go to rugby, you go to swimming even, if somebody missteps and hit their head against the pool. Where does it end?
Well, like I said, I would draw the line at rugby and football, and I would expect us not to be afraid to be different. If somebody is just coming to us for rugby or football, you know what? What if people just say, wow, there's a board that really puts the well-being of people first?
Back
maybe
to my
more
question, Madam Chair,
us.
What would stop people from going from Mars to the co-terminus board across the street?
All I'm saying is maybe more people will come to us if we stand for something.
Thank you.
Some might leave and some more might come.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Trustee Bruno Enica.
Thank you, Madam Chair. You have it on. Have you presented at Peel Board, considering that they're approximately two-thirds what we are? Have you presented to the appeal board?
No.
You haven't?
No.
Okay. With regards to the poster that you have, the first young man that you mentioned, can you repeat his name again?
Danny Castillo.
Was that a scenario of a couple of years ago at a game where did he attend the Peel Board?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, so that was a scenario where he didn't die from playing the sport. He died because somebody picked him up and dropped him on his head. That was not part of the game that was going on. That was after the fact. It wasn't, it was during the game, yes, but it was not because of the sport itself. It was because of an aggression that the one player had. That's the second.
May I answer that? May I say something to that?
Sure.
Okay. See, this is one of about 100 things that we could deal with if we had people doing this fratelli tutti. We're all brothers and sisters, and we can reason. That's one of about 100 issues that we could deal with. I would say that we put them out there doing this aggressive sport together, and then it got carried away. There was an illegal tackle where he picked him up and drove him in, and it's known as an illegal tackle. So yes, you're right that it was after the whistle and an illegal tackle. But I would argue that the fact that they were out playing rugby is part of the problem.
They could have been out playing street hockey too. Or they could have been out just having a beer. Anyway, I regress. So do you plan on going to the appeal board?
I don't have any plans, but I might. Good idea, I don't know.
Well, you've been here 3 times. You haven't been there at all. And their flagship, for the most part, is football, rugby. I'm surprised that you wouldn't go to a larger audience as well, like at the same time, not just Dufferin Peel. So why just Dufferin Peel?
I guess, you know, I've been a Catholic educator. This is my 40th year. I believe in it passionately. And I believe that we can make a difference to the culture, bring peace and nonviolence, and I would like us to be different. You know what? I might take you up on your suggestion, and I do believe that if we were to form a little committee, it would be ideal to work with people from the other board as well.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Trustee Anisha Thomas.
Through the chair, that individual that you were mentioning, he was directly associated with the Peel School Board. So why haven't you been to the Peel School Board and present them with this case?
Because, like I said, I would expect the Catholic Board, reverence for life is fundamental to what we're trying to do, right? And I would expect us to be the one to make a difference. This is the board that I work in. But I'd be happy to go over across the street too, you know, and I do believe if we had a committee that we should try to work with them as well. But again, it's about, I would expect something special of us.
Thank you. Seeing no other question, thank you, Mr. Bellin. Are there any, do you still have a question to the delegate? Do you have a question?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I do have a question. Just the through you, the medical ethics paper in schools that you referenced, is that, I see it's a paper copy. Is it possible if you have a digital link that you could send to our recorder, Cindy, and that could be shared with trustees so we can
very happy
give you?
It's a fantastic read.
Thank you.
And, you know, part of it is, one section of it says uninformed consent. So the response in the Catholic Register was, you know, we get parent consent, and it deals with that issue. It's a beautiful article. Thank you for asking.
I would love to read it, and I think if you could share it with our recorder, and then you could pass it on to the Board of Trustees, that would be great. Thank you.
Trustee Valoria, do you have a question to the delegate?
Yes. To you, Madam Chair. You mentioned, Tony, that you've been here more than once. Ask a question which you said hasn't been answered. Was that question answered tonight?
No. You see, fratelli tutti says long periods of silence and so on. It would take a committee probably months, meeting once a week for an hour or two to go through it and then make recommendations. It's almost like there should be an inquiry. Like, you know, an inquiry when something really bad happens. One of our students died playing football, and we just continued. I think that it would be good to, again, fratelli tutti calls us to
Tony.
Dialogue, deep dialogue.
Tony.
No, it hasn't been answered.
Yeah. Rather than, if I follow your line of thought, you would rather that we start an inquiry at this point without stopping it altogether? Is that
Oh, yes, a good one? Yes. Because I'd be very happy with dialogue. And the president of my parent council is willing. Joseph Canary is willing. I'm willing. If there was three of me and two or three of you, I can meet during March break, Saturdays, anytime, and go through. And one of the first things
we might do. Okay, is that answering your question then?
Well, yeah, yes or no to having a committee would be an
yes
answer to the question.
Okay. Yes. So having an inquiry into the continuance of football or rugby in Dufferin Peel.
Exactly.
Okay. So that's a question, and here's the answer. We'll try and give you an answer.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Are there any questions to the staff? Trustee Bria Corbett.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and through you, I'm not sure if staff have this information, but are we aware of any student deaths related to rugby or football in our board? I know Peel Board was mentioned that there was.
Mr. Whelan, you may be excused. You can go back to the gallery, Mr. Whelan.
And through the chair, if there's not an answer tonight, that's fair. Just throwing that out there, I don't want to minimize the seriousness of the issue if there hasn't been a death in our board, but did want to at least ask the question.
Through the chair, we would ask that you give us an opportunity to go back and look at the request.
Absolutely. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Student Trustee Leroy.
Through the chair, in regards to our process post student having a concussion in hockey, rugby, football, etc.
Just on a microphone.
Is better?
Yeah.
So in regards to our concussion protocol, is the board's concussion protocol proprietary? Do we just follow what ROPSA or any other?
Through the chair, we don't take our direction from ROPSA. We take our direction from Ministry Policy and Procedure, most notably PPM 158, which has to do with concussions and concussion protocol, Sabrina's Law, coupled with our OSBI risk management and insurance, and also OFIA, the Ontario Physical and Health Education Association.
And then in regards to equipment, do we have...
Sorry, that was Rowan's Law, not Sabrina's Law. Messed up with my laws.
In regards to equipment in football, do we have a renewal process? Do we have currently the process to see whether or not a helmet that's been being used or that was bought has been adequate? Do we have a process of buying or acquiring?
Through the chair, OFIA has very stringent guidelines that school boards follow. In one of those guidelines has to do with helmet certification. So we adhere to all of those policies.
Are you done? Thank you, Trustee Paula.
Through the chair, I just wanted to ask if we could get a number of serious injuries or deaths from football and rugby in particular in our board, when you have the time, of course. Thank you.
Through the chair, if I may, that will be part of the report that we bring forward to the February 14th Faith and Program Committee meeting.
Thank you. Are there any other questions? No. Madam Director, next.
Through the chair, we're on D6. We're pleased to welcome Taras Snahura. I apologize if I've... Oh, thank you. To the podium to present on violence.
Chair. Good evening. Honored trustees. My name is Taras Snahura. I graduated from University of Toronto when I played football at St. Michael's College for two seasons there. Fortunate. unfortunately, aforementioned teenagers. Not the case. These teenagers did lose their lives to rugby and football. Sports do destroy the body. This issue is not new. Esteemed teacher, Toronto Board, Ed Schmidt, wrote about this in his memoirs, Never Neutral. He also was a football player at St. Mike's. He wrote in 1978, commented on a Sports Illustrated article, said the issue is not only dead bodies, but also wounded ones. Systematic wasting of men and boys within the legal play, boundaries of legal play. It was on also to quote from a sportscaster, put it up pretty straight, the name of Roger Kahn, and one of the deans of American sports writing, put it very succinctly. Football is terrifically violent. It is a game of impact, twisted knees, concussions. There, as already mentioned, Mr. Whelan, about Damar Hamlin almost losing his life on January 2nd, and which brought up the issue about people questioning the violence of the game and whether it has a place in society collectively, larger context. As important as that issue is on that level, it's not our localized specific issue. Ours is whether it is right and fit for young people. Is it right for young people in our schools? So why do we participate in sports that can kill? The Toronto Star had a headline, and we already heard that earlier as well. Football kills, but nobody really cares. It's kind of with this, I say things with my left hand, but my right hand continues to do this, and living this sort of dichotomy here. So we have to definitely try to rewrite that headline at some point. Looking at and trying to get some clarity on this issue. And we talked about, taking small steps. We have a concussion protocol. But they don't solve the problem. We will hear from Mr. Roach, who will do a deep dive into the science of CTE. So besides these deaths, though, how many more young people are going to develop CTE? He's been let. Regarding CTE, I'd like to share with you a part of that podcast that Mr. Whelan has been up called The Burden of Proof by Malcolm Galdo. He speaks of a gentleman by the name of Owen Thomas, and it is believed that he developed CTE playing football. Here is a portion of that podcast I'd like to share with you, and I'd like to warn you it does deal with the issue of suicide. Owen Thomas went to the University of Pennsylvania, and he was named captain of the football team. 76 out of 80 players voted for him, and then one day out of the blue, in the spring of his junior year, he hung himself in his apartment. Parents drove down to Philadelphia. They went to identify their son's body in the hospital. In the car on the way back on this terrible, terrible day, he got a call from someone named Chris Nowinski. Nowinski is a former college football player with a PhD in neuroscience who runs the Concussion Legacy Foundation. He works with a group of researchers at Boston University, and for more than a decade, they've been autopsying the brains of people who have suffered and died as a result of repeated blows to the head, looking for something called traumatic encephalopathy, it's CTE. So far, Nowinski's group has autopsied the brains of approximately 111 former NFL players, 110 of them had CTE. 7 of 8 former CFL players had it. 9 of 14 pro players, 48 of 53 college players, 3 out of 14 Now, is this proof of a connection between CTE in the form of players getting hit in the head in football? No. But remember, they're working from a non-representative sample. Autopsies conducted by players whose families believe something was wrong. Proof would be if you identified, say, 2,000 people, half of whom played football, did not. Then over the course of their lives, compare the autopsies of their brains. The football players have, on average, more of the protein tau in their brain tissue than non-football players. The problem is that the average of the American life expectancy is 75. Unfortunately, as a result of his death, Penn State did make a statement. He said, "We're aware of this, but yet Penn State does continue to play." I can conclude, if there are degrees of wrong, then risking young people to play and risking their lives and brain health. Very serious. This time, for your time.
Thank you. Are there any questions to the delegate? No question. Thank you, Mr. Madam Director, are there any questions to the?
Through the chair, we're at D7. I'm pleased to welcome Michael Herniak to the podium to delegate on violent sports.
Madam Chair and esteemed trustees, administrators and staff, real honor and privilege to be here with you. And I come respectfully before you this evening as a concerned member of the Catholic community and a theologian. I've been working in Catholic ministry for over 40 years. As you heard tonight, the presenting issue is the board policy on football programs and other contact sports, and whether a new policy will be considered in light of the risks to our students' minds, hearts, and bodies. I don't have stats or numbers for you tonight. I just have a heartfelt appeal. I believe my fellow delegates have presented some compelling arguments for a change in policy, and especially on violent sports, and I hope you'll consider those arguments carefully in your discernment, perhaps even a committee. I hope that you'll consider them and make some changes. Or consider some changes. I'm here, however, to raise a deeper, more fundamental issue and to extend a challenge to you as trustees to consider something more basic. It has to do with your calling and my calling and what Monsignor was talking about in terms of the Beatitudes. What we're talking tonight about is a difference in the way that we do education. We form young people. In the book of Proverbs, it states, without a vision, the people will perish. Without a vision, the people will perish. So the term trustee implies to me a public trust that we have invested in you as leaders by the Catholic community to hold a vision, to hold a higher vision. The trust that we've invested in you as Catholic Christians is a Catholic Christian vision, and a trust that you will faithfully execute your duties, uphold Catholic values and teaching, and not just policies related to sports, but all policies that guide us here in Dufferin Peel. I believe this is a sacred call by Catholic parents and citizens, and a sacred trust that we have placed in you, not just a paid position or a bureaucratic function. We actually really need you to hold a higher vision. Uphold the highest ideals of our faith, and not just to be in compliance with provincial safety regulations governing sports or any other domain of public education, to aim a little higher. We're here to just invite you in this matter and all matters to be faithful to the call that you have received from us and from God, to stand in your policies for something higher than secular humanism, neoliberalism, or bureaucratic conformity. Yes, we're in conformity with certain provincial ministry guidelines, but we're aiming higher, I hope. So integrity in this trust means formulating policy that is congruent with the Catholic ideals and values that we espouse, not just enrollment figures and popular student demand. To bring our Catholic rhetoric into reality through wise and just policies. So the issue of whether to support violent sports programs that cause lethal injuries, if you'll forgive me, is a no-brainer. Jesus said, No one can serve two masters. Either you'll hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. So my question is, will this board, in its policies, serve the God of Jesus Christ, the nonviolent Savior, the God who preaches the Beatitudes, and develop policy that reflects gospel values of care, compassion, cooperation, and community? Or will it serve the world and develop policy that reflects the values of strength, competition, winning, and success that are dominant in our market-based culture and secular society? We all know that there are difficult choices to be made in a faith-based school district that serves in a government-funded system. And I am very grateful that you're willing to make those choices for us. But faith matters. Faith matters. So thank you for listening, and I hope and pray you'll make those policies in alignment with the gospel.
Thank you, Mr. Reinert.
Mr. Herren.
Herren. Are there any questions to the of clarification to the delegate? Thank you. Thank you again. Thank you
for your attention.
Are there any questions to the staff? Next delegate.
Through the chair, we're at D8, and I'm pleased to welcome Brian Roach to the podium to delegate on violent sports. Thank you. Correction, it is a delegation that's coming through on Zoom.
Sorry, a second.
Okay, are you ready to start? We're going to start.
Yes, time. I am.
Okay. Go ahead.
Great. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to present this virtually. I'd like to explain why repetitive hits to the head that occur in high impact sports such as football are more dangerous than we thought. For decades, high-impact sports such as football have normalized hits to the head as just part of the game. Most players just shake it off and play on. As research on head impacts have progressed, so too has the understanding that these types of impacts should be avoided. Improvements to helmet technology and some rule changes have been implemented to reduce the number of concussions, but with questionable success. In the past, a brain injury like a concussion was thought to be a one-time event. Like a broken bone or a torn ligament, you're injured, you heal, you return to play. More recently, a better understanding of concussions has led to a much greater awareness of the serious nature of this type of brain injury, especially for repeated concussions. Coaches, officials, and players are now taught how to recognize a concussion, and protocols around return to play are more strictly enforced. But now, evidence shows that repetitive head impacts don't need to produce a concussion to develop a progressive degenerative disease known as chronic traumatic encephalopathy, or CTE. CTE can be caused by the hundreds of smaller impacts that occur every season on the line of scrimmage. And the symptoms of CTE don't show up until years or decades later. These symptoms that show up in athletes with CTE are often personality or mood changes, including depression, aggression and violent behavior, loss of impulse control, memory loss, and dementia. Unfortunately, there is as of yet no way to diagnose CTE until after death, when the brain can be examined microscopically. To understand how this damage occurs, let's take a quick look at the structure of a brain cell. Brain cells, or neurons, are uniquely shaped with long, thin extensions called axons, which help neurons connect with each other. These axons are used to transmit signals from cell to cell. Axons are about 100 times smaller than the diameter of a human hair, and so are usually the point of breakage in a neuron. With a concussion or other types of traumatic brain injury, these broken neurons impair brain activity and are difficult to repair. But as I said previously, we know now that concussions are not associated with CTE. So how does the damage that causes CTE occur? Inside all of our cells are small tubes called microtubules. These are constantly being assembled and reassembled as needed to form a network that gives our cells shape and act like a conveyor belt to transport materials from one end to another. This is my favorite clip for biology classes. You can see a motor proton walking along the length of a microtubule. Head impacts that bend, stretch, or twist the cells in the brain can rupture the microtubules even without breaking the axon. So a blow to the head that doesn't result in a concussion can still end up damaging the microtubules. So why does this matter? Well, microtubules are stabilized by proteins called tau protein, seen here in red. When microtubules are damaged or broken, tau proteins can misfold, detach, and float freely inside the cell. Then they can clump together. Once these proteins start misfolding, even without additional trauma, they can cause other tau proteins within the same cell to misfold and malfunction, impairing cell function. Then they can spread to other cells, causing those tau proteins to misfold and form tangles, which will eventually disrupt cell function, even causing the cell to burst open, leaving only the tangles. These tangles form lesions in the brain, visible with a microscope. And this abnormal buildup of tau proteins is progressive and continues even after an athlete retires from the game. So players who were older when they died tend to have more extensive tau buildup.
1 minute to go.
There's a variety of neurodegenerative diseases characterized by abnormal deposits of these tau proteins, including Alzheimer's, dementia, and Parkinsonism. In CTE, these deposits occur in a unique pattern, clustering around the blood vessels in the frontal and temporal lobes of the brain. These lesions can result in microscopic and macroscopic changes to the brain, resulting in progressive brain degeneration. Dr. Anne McKee from Boston University is a leading authority on CTE. Her studies of hundreds of brains donated to the Boston Brain Bank have shown that with every 2.6 years of playing football, the risk of CTE doubles. We also know that the incidence of CTE is approximately 30% among athletes with repetitive brain injuries. There are so many health benefits to sport, but now we know that tackle football is dangerous. The benefits no longer outweigh the risks. For these reasons, I feel that tackle football should no longer be supported in our schools, especially when there are so many safer options for student athletes. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any questions to the delegate? No. Thank you, Mr. Roach, for the presentation. Are there any questions to the staff? Student Trustee Diaz-Sicali.
To the chair, in addition to the concussion training, are there any other training processes, either athletic or medical, in order to prevent injuries?
So through the chair, all of our coaches need to be certified in line with OFIA, and part of that is concussion awareness and proper techniques for training. So we're in line with all of the provincial guidelines and policies in that matter.
Thank you. Any other questions to the staff? Trustee Bria.
Thanks, Madam Chair. This was our last presentation this evening for the delegations, right? If there's other questions that trustees have, I would go last, so just wanted to let you know.
Okay. Are there any questions to the staff? Looks like there's no other questions. Go ahead, Trustee Corbett.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and through you. I want to thank the delegates for coming this evening. It's obvious and evident that you are concerned about the well-being of our students, the health of of our students long-term, well past the years that they are in our secondary schools. So I wanna thank you for taking out the time and the care to bring the information once again to our board. I think it's important that we remember we can't have academic achievement without health. I'm a parent of three children who attend our board. Two are in secondary. They are actively involved in sports, contact sports, school-related extracurricular sports. My background before I was a trustee, I'm a regulated healthcare professional. So I support keeping our students active and engaged in physical activity, in sports, in school, in a safe manner. I think there is nothing more worrisome than when there is an injury or an illness to any child that could have been prevented. I know we honor Rowan's Law, her memory, and it still affects me that it took a devastating loss of her life related to head injuries in a sport to raise concussion safety. And it also, because of that event, raised information and awareness about second impact syndrome. And it actually surprised me that it wasn't until 2018 that Rowan's Law was passed in the legislature. So we think of it as something that's been around for a while, but it's actually not been. So I do think we need to continue to raise awareness. I think we also need strategies that identify, that manage, and prevent concussions and CTE, as was evident in the last presentation, they are different. I also think we need a provincial strategy, though. And I think we need updated standards with the ministry directives for all boards, not just ours. Because if it's unsafe for our board, it is also unsafe and at risk for all students. There are 72 school boards in the province of Ontario. So through the chair, I know we've informed the delegates tonight that there's no decision that's going to be made. I recognize Trustee Mario Pascucci has asked for a report to come forward at Faith and Program. In preparation for that report, and since we do take our direction from the Ministry of Education, Madam Chair, I would like to put a motion on the floor this evening that our board brings the concerns of CTE forward to the attention of the ministry in the form of a letter from our Board of Trustees. And it would include the information that the delegates have presented this evening. So Madam Chair, I do have a fulsome motion if I could read, but with your permission, thank you. Whereas the research on CTE, chronic traumatic encephalopathy, is limited and still ongoing. Whereas the Canadian Pediatric Society released a position paper in January 2023 regarding CTE sport-related head injuries in hockey without recommendations for football or rugby. Whereas none of the professional bodies to date, Ontario Physical and Health Education Association, OFHEA, Parachute Canada, Canadian Medical Association, CMA, or the Ministry of Education have published any position papers on CTE. Whereas no other school boards in the GTA provide information on CTE in their concussion protocols, or have discontinued football, rugby, or contact sports as a result of CTE. Whereas Dufferin-Peel Catholic District School Board remains in compliance with the Ontario School Board Insurance Exchange, OSPE, as well as PPM 158 from the Ministry of Education, School Board Policies on Concussion and OFHEA. Be it resolved that the Chair of the Board, on behalf of the Dufferin-Peel Catholic District School Board Board of Trustees, write a letter to the Ministry of Education with copies to Ontario Catholic School Trustees Association, OCSTA, requesting a review of the emerging evidence and research on CTE and provide direction for school boards regarding preventative action for contact sports in schools. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Could I get a mover? Motion. Moved by Trustee Bria Corbett.
Thank you.
I have seconded by Trustee Paula D'Amato. Discussion? And the motion? All in favor? Carried. Thank you. Showman unanimous.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, trustees, and thank you for our delegates this evening.
Thank you again to the delegates came forward as well as Mr. Rowe. Trustee Daryl D'Souza. You are in favor, right?
Yes, yes, Madam Chair.
It's unanimous.
Through the chair, we're on section E, which is updates and information reports from trustees for receipt. E1A is the Ontario Catholic School Trustees Association report.
Madam Director, before I do that, could I miss A8, which is the approval of minutes of the special board meeting of January 17, 2023, which is there's a public session on that one.
Through the chair, I believe you did approve that. We approved it less, but no, there was an open item.
There was an open
item. I thought it was approved less the declared item.
Madam Chair, if it hasn't been approved for the recorder, I'd like to move that.
We did not approve. So moved by Trustee Stefano Pascucci, seconded by Trustee Bruno Anika. All in favor? Thank you. All right, so we're going on to item
E1A, which is the Ontario Catholic School Trustees Association report.
Thank you. For that agenda will be number. Agenda page number. We're now in the report. I'm going to read my report. I'll pass on the chair to Vice Chair Trustee Thomas Thomas. It's a brief report. On Friday, January 20th and Saturday, January 21st, I attended the Oxa Catholic Seminar together with Trustees Paula D'Amato Giovanazzi, Trustee Thomas Thomas, and Director Maria Maserato. Our keynote speaker was David Wells, who talked about placing Christ at the center. What is the center and what is Christ doing there? I sent out the links to online access to the key presentation, and hopefully you'll find the time to listen to David Wells as well as David Coletto. David Coletto is the one that talked about the trend, and this is where you get the chat GPT information that he talked about. The workshops were also very informative, which includes equity, diversity, and inclusion, legislation, policy, and faith. An overview of code of conduct requirements for school board as legislated under the education. I just want to add, OXA AGM is to be held on April 27th to 29th at Toronto. I encourage you to please register. So again, there's a lot of workshops and information that will be shared. I believe on April 26th, there's also a finance session, which I have not seen. So just mark that in your calendar and we'll send it out as soon as it comes out. The next board meeting of OXA is on Friday, February 3rd. We'll send out the highlights. That concludes our report.
Have any question to Luz regarding your OCSCA? You don't need to receive the.
Thank you.
Through the chair, E1B is the student voice report.
Good evening, trustees, staff, and public attendees. My name is Lira Inoha, the student trustee for the North of Dufferin Peel Catholic School Board.
And my name is Dea Sokoli, student trustee for the South. We are grateful to be presenting our January Student Voice Report on this first board meeting of the new year.
Student trustee elections are in full swing. Secondary school administrators have been sent information regarding the elections and are in the process of selecting school candidates who will attend the board-wide election on February 22nd. In the meantime, on February 6th, I and Dale will be hosting a student trustee informational session in which we will outline the duties and responsibilities of a student trustee. We will stress how crucial the position is to student advocacy, the time commitment needed to be successful in the role. Candidates will also have the opportunity to ask questions about our experiences during our terms.
The Student Senate and most student councils have halted meetings for the month of January in order to prioritize exams. However, the Senate was still active in promoting our Senate Instagram and introductions. In addition, OSTA Student Wellbeing Working Group has begun working with OFIA on a project aiming to implement more intramurals in school communities. We thank the Senate for relaying important information, and we look forward to seeing this project unfold. Our next Senate meeting will be held this Thursday, February 2nd.
With the emergence of the artificial intelligence program ChatGPT created by the company OpenAI, The tool, Student Senate has noticed students have been utilizing the tool to assist them in homework and other class assignments. This technology presents a tremendous opportunity in education. It also highlights gaps in our current curriculum and pedagogy. Student Senate believes our goal should be to properly integrate these burgeoning technologies into the classroom whilst ensuring students continue to learn the material outlined in the Ontario curriculum. The Senate will look to work with the board's programming department to identify potential applications of these new tools.
And before we end off, we would like to extend a warm congratulations to all our secondary students who have completed their exams. We wish everyone a wonderful second semester for 2023. In addition, we would like to take some time to recognize St. Michael's Mental Health Champions, who were featured on CTV News for their work supporting students during exam season. Their commitment to their peers goes to show the fraternity that should be made accessible to students during this time of stress. We greatly applaud the efforts taken to accommodate the students and the success received from such a great initiative.
That concludes our January Student Voice Report. Thank you for your attentive. If you have any questions, we'd be happy to take them now.
Thank you. Are there any questions? Trustee Mary Pascucci.
Board, a question after. How does your student know what you're saying tonight in terms of communication?
Well, we try as much as possible to let the student senators know that all the board meetings are live streamed. 7 p.m. last Tuesday of the month. We remind them from time to time. I occasionally post on my Instagram that we are having a board meeting. I did let a couple of my friends know that we are having a board meeting tonight, that they might be on the YouTube channel right now. But our main avenue of communication is through the Student Senate.
Your main distribution is, I'm sorry, what did you say?
Through the Student Senate.
Through you, Madam Chair, to Madam Director. How can we improve the communications on something like this that's so important when we recognize that we want these students to come forward, put their name forward, just in terms of bringing it forward? I mean, they're doing a great job. Thank you very much. It's a wonderful report. You're always timely. They're well coordinated and they're well thought out. Just that extra step to get the individual students that they represent fully aware of what's being said for them and on their behalf.
Well, through the chair, we can continue to work with the student trustees to look at ways in which we can enhance the communication.
You know, Madam Chair, do you have any ideas that you'd like to share in terms of making it more available or making it more widespread?
I think the utilization of our social media platforms is really important. I think most students who have Instagram, most students who have Twitter, most students are on YouTube. So if we can get to them with the places where they're looking at in the first place, that communication is going to be, I guess, improved. So Instagram, I think, is most paramount. We're growing our Instagram account, so any trustees that do have Instagram, please follow us on there. And then also pushing the fact that we do live stream these board meetings on YouTube every last Tuesday of the month.
And then to you, Madam Chair, last question. Is there any way we can track this in terms of absolute numbers, January this year versus January next year, every 6 months, 9 months, once a year, I think is enough. Possibility of using that as a method of tracking and to make sure that your audience is building.
I think the best tool that we have is the engagement on the Instagram and Twitter, okay, our great social media platforms. You can tell by the amount of followers we have and the number of viewers that we have on each individual post that we put onto these platforms.
I think what you should do is establish a couple of words that are keywords and put it on the chat. Let artificial intelligence take care of it. Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you. And thank you, Madam Director. I appreciate it.
Are there any other questions? Could I just ask that you send us your Instagram? No more questions? Thank you for the report, Madam Director.
Through the chair, E1C is good news items.
Any good news item?
Thank you, Madam Chair, and through you. Just wanted to share recently CTV News featured the incredible work being done at one of our schools in Mississauga North, St. Alberta of Jerusalem, Catholic Elementary School. Our staff and our students were featured in the wellness and mental health that they've been promoting throughout the school. We know it's especially important at this time
throughout the pandemic. And so I want to thank all the staff for contributing to the positive environment for our students as well as our staff. It's wonderful to see the caring environment that they've been doing and the initiatives they've been taking on, like Kate. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Corbett. Trustee Pollard.
Through the chair, I had the same experience as Brea had. We had CTV Bell and Bell Let's Talk participate at my school at St. Michael's. Robert F. Hall. St. Michael's in Bolton, sorry.
Yeah.
And it was such an honor. I was actually there that day and it was quite fun. So it was really nice to see all the students participating and all the artwork that they had out and all the suggestions and all the ideas. It was a really fun event and I was happy to be a part of it. And I wanted to thank everybody who organized it. It was quite well. Thank you so much.
Are there any other questions about good news items? Madam Director.
Through the chair, we're now on section 8, which is the updates and information reports from committees for receipt. And I'm going to turn that over to you to go through each one.
Right. You have in front of you the minutes of the Administration and Finance Committee meeting of November 8, 2022, on page 50. Are there any questions or comments? The new regulation, Stephen. No questions or comments? Item number 2, minutes of the Faith and Program Committee meeting of October 11, 2022. Any questions or comments of that minute? That's on page 58. No questions or comments. Item number 3, minutes of the Contract and Negotiations Committee meeting December 13, 2022, page 65. Are there any questions or comments? Item number 4, minutes of the Special Education Advisory Committee meeting of December 7, 2022, on page 70. Any comments or questions? Trustee Bruna Anika.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I attended that night. I've been sitting on this board for 31 years. I have to admit that I have enjoyed some. None, absolutely none more than that. Prior to COVID, we used to have a night. Students would accompany the representative and it would be a family. And this certainly was a family. And I can tell you that young men and young women that came that evening had a blast, a wonderful time. And for those that were there, you could easily understand why this would be the highlight, everybody, not just the committee members, but all members. Just the smile on kids' faces was, and I mean, so it has to be, that night has to be the highlight, but honestly, meetings that I have ever attended. I look forward to every year. Continue to have.
Any other comments for item number?
No. Through the chair, we're now on G1, the retirement of Angie Pilon, who was a principal of the school. And before trustees, on page 74 of your e-agenda is the retirement letter from Principal Pilon. Angie began with Dufferin Peel in 2017 as the principal of St. Barbara. She wasn't with us long. Her philosophy of education has been one of service to others. She's also valued and supported the strong relationship between home, school, and parish. We congratulate and wish Angie well.
Thank you. Are there any...
Through the chair, we're now moving to section H, and these are trustee and committee administration reports that require action. H1 is the motion recommended by the Administration and Finance Committee of January 17, 2023, found on page 76.
have a motion that the Board of Trustees approve the terms of reference for the Administration and Finance Committee 2023. Could I have Trustee Daryl D'Souza to move?
Thank you, Madam Chair.
By Trustee Daryl D'Souza, seconded by Trustee Bria Corbett. All in favor? Thank you.
Through the chair, H2 are motions recommended by the Faith and Program Committee of January 24th, 2023, found on page 78.
It be the desire of the trustees that I read the combined the two reports. We vote once only. Separately, okay for everybody. Okay, first item that the Board of Trustees approved for submission, tutoring funding resolution. Whereas many students require additional learning opportunities that extend beyond the scope of the classroom teacher in order to close learning gaps and or consolidate their learning. And whereas as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, significant learning gaps for many students as they continually transition between in-person and remote learning styles over the past 2 years. And whereas tutors during the school day after school evening Saturdays played a significant role in supplementing classroom learning supports to help students close learning gaps and or consolidate student learning. And whereas school boards do not have the source funding to meet the demand providing additional tutoring support, which have been so crucial to student learning. Therefore, be it resolved that OXA petition the Ministry of Education to ensure that ongoing and annual funding be provided to school boards so that additional tutoring support may still be offered to students who needed to close learning gaps and or consolidate their learning. Moved by Trustee Mary Petrucci, seconded by
On January 29th, the Toronto Star is looking at an article here. If I may just read briefly here, it says, amidst heightened concerns over learning gaps due to pandemic-related alternative schedules and remote instruction, in a drive to catch up on the Ministry of Education and School Board, $175 million to expand tutorial as well as $365 million job payments to parents and $250 per child training. And I recognize this is a lot of open money. This was a contributor to the Toronto Star. I'll give it to staff just for reference. The fact of the matter is that it is a serious concern.
So we have a mover and seconder. All in favor?
Aye. It is unanimous.
Unanimous for that. Oh, and
Daryl.
Thank you. I saw that one. Second item that the Board of Trustees approved the terms of reference for the Faith and Program Committee 2023. Moved by Trustee Bruno Anika, seconded by Trustee Herman Valoria. All in favor?
Through the chair, H3 is the election of a trustee to represent the Dufferin-Peel Catholic District School Board on the Toronto Region Conservation Authority, the Natural Science and Education Committee. This is a 4-year term.
Yes, just a point of clarification. Well, we did elect a representative, I think, last year, and now they have aligned their board of directors with the municipal election. So now they're asking us to again nominate a trustee representative that will hold the position for 4 years, just in line with our term as well. So in this regard, do I have nomination for this position?
Madam Chair, I would like to nominate Trustee Stefano Pascucci.
Trustee Stefano Pascucci, do you accept the nomination?
Thank you, Madam Chair, but I do not. I decline. Thank you.
Are there any nominations?
Nobody else? I can continue that.
Nobody else?
Because I stayed last 1 year. And anybody else interested? Okay, no.
Nobody else? I can
continue. No. Last year, I called three committees.
Nobody else? Because I stayed last 1 year.
I thought it was Thomas Thomas. I see Daryl D'Souza, do you have a comment? No.
Nobody else, if you want to go, you can go. If not, I'll go.
Are there any other nominations?
Thomas Thomas.
Okay, Trustee Thomas Thomas.
I thought it was Thomas Thomas. See Daryl D'Souza, do you have a comment?
No, Madam Chair, I was thinking of nominating Trustee Thomas Thomas.
Through the chair, are any of you actually watching the live feed on your computers? Because that's where the feedback is coming.
We're not on.
To the chair, yes.
Okay, so seeing no other nomination, Trustee Thomas Thomas has been nominated. So the motion is that the Board of Trustees approve the election of Trustee Thomas Thomas to represent Dufferinfield Catholic District School Board and the Toronto and Region Conservation Authority, Natural Science and Education Committee. Term will align with the municipal election ending November 2026. Could I have a mover, please? By Trustee Mario Pascucci, seconded by Trustee Bruno Anika. All in favor? Thank you. It's unanimous. It's okay. We don't have it. Next item, Madam.
Through the chair, H4 is the motion recommended by the Special Education Advisory Committee of January 25th of 2023. It's found on page 81 of your agenda.
That the Board of Trustees approve the terms of reference for the Special Education Advisory Committee 2023. Moved by Trustee Bruno Anika, seconded by Trustee Anisha Thomas. All in favor? Thank you.
Through the chair, there's no notices of motion or additional business. We're on section K, questions asked of and by trustee.
Okay, I'm going to make a list. So I have Trustee Mary Pascucci, Trustee Stefano Pascucci, Trustee Bruno Anita, Trustee Bria Corbett, Trustee Paula Mato, and Trustee Herman Viloria. Okay, Trustee Mary Pascucci, you can start.
This is to staff, and you answered it last 2 weeks ago. Regarding status of St. Sophia, is there anything new and exciting about the enrollment, the registration, or is it pretty well status quo? And if it is, where are we at? I don't expect a fulsome report because it is just a question of that. Yeah.
So through the chair, with regards to enrollment, specifically JK enrollment, the registration window for JK enrollment closed last Friday, which was January 27th. As we all know, and as has been communicated to the community, the cap in JK is 60 in enrollment as of Friday, and the deadline was 58. So we came in under the cap, so no random selection is required for the JK students that registered at the school, and the school administrator and staff have been communicating with those that registered so that they're aware that they are in and that no random selection is required.
Let me ask a 1B question. Sorry, through you to Madam to Mr. Bianco. What about if the student went to register at another school in a local area? They have an option to come to St. Sophia.
So through the chair, aside from I think two grades, and we're just going to confirm those, all the other grades are above the 60 student cap. So there are no opportunities to enroll in any other grade except for one or two, but we'll confirm those and we'll have more to share with trustees later this week or early next week.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. This is a regional school, so I'd like to have, make sure everybody's involved and included. And I like the, obviously, the information to go out to the community as quickly as possible, for obvious reasons. I'm asking questions. Mr. Verity, thank you for preparing that. Appreciate it, Daniel.
Trustee Stepanopoulos.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Through you, I was at a school council meeting and a question came up about the public budget consultation. I know last year during the pandemic, it was open to chairs only. Is it going to be the same this year, or is it going to be open to the full school, Catholic school councils?
So through the chair, less loud through the chair. See it. The chair, a report is coming forward about the what is the budget development process for 23-24. It's coming forward at the next ANF meeting. But in addition to that, yes, we did hold, I think last year it was actually two sessions. We held one specifically for chairs, but we also held a broader public consultation as well. This year, although it's not finalized, it would probably be just one for the broader community itself.
Thank you, because I know that many many school councils, they go around this public consultation. They have their meeting beforehand and then you know, all sit together and do that. So thank you very much. Another question through you, Madam Chair, to Associate Director Del Bianco. I think Matthew Thomas is there too. Just out of curiosity, when it comes to the snow removal at our schools, is that centrally negotiated, or is it one provider, multiple providers? Sorry, I didn't provide this question earlier. It's fine.
Through the chair, I'm hoping this works. Through the chair, the facility operations department here at Dufferin Peel has centralized contracts with multiple service providers. We do it geographically through different parts of the board, and those contracts with the providers are intended to ensure that they clear off our parking lots, our driveways, and then our custodial staff would take care of the walkways and the front entrances.
Thank you. And who, so you said driveways, parking lots, in front of the schools, as well as the play areas?
Through the chair, the play areas as well would be taken care of by the contractors. The front entranceways, sidewalks in front of the schools are usually done by the custodial staff.
Thank you. Now, would the play areas also include the FTK fenced in areas if there is access?
Through the chair, my understanding is that would not be the case.
Play area. Well, some schools do have like larger gates. Now, I've never in front of a school when it snows, so I don't know how big these trucks are. I'm assuming they're very large. So I guess if they can't access them, then that's fine. Just out of curiosity.
Yeah. So through the chair, my understanding is they don't do the FTK play areas. I believe they do the play areas behind the schools.
Yes. Yes.
For the older students.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Trustee Brunei.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I have multiple questions. I'll ask three and then go back into the line if I could. Are our children that learn differently allowed to go outside to play with other children?
Through the chair, yes.
So are they supervised?
Through the chair, yes.
Okay. Some would not. Would that be a correct assumption? And not through limitations, if I may. Even with children with limitations. Yes.
Through the chair, the goal is always to provide as many integration opportunities, including at recess with other students.
Madam Chair, if I could, can staff please look into the practices at schools relating to how students choose other students to be on teams?
Through the chair, yes, we will.
And Madam Chair, as I know I'm not special, so I'm assuming that each and every one of you have received same comments, remarks regarding our procurement process. If staff could look into, originally I had requested staff for a meeting with my community, but my community is everybody else's community, whether we represent it or not. So can I ask staff to look into having a date to explain the procurement process and allow staff or allow parents to ask questions that they may have, because it seems to me that every month at every school of this board that I attend, it's the same question. I'm a different community, but it's the same question. And I go back to staff with the same question as I've heard some of my colleagues as well. And the reason that I ask, because there's a besides the fact that there are significant number of questions regarding why I have to pay so much for a football when I can get it at Kmart or Walmart at a different price. But one of the challenges that one of the schools of this board that I represent wanted to buy a sound system, and the vendor that was on in the procurement process, there was only one. So for me, they have a monopoly on that market, which creates a bit of a challenge, because in looking at the quote, and I've looked at it, there's $500 for a portion of what appears to be parking. Now, I know that during the school day, parking can be a challenge, but I know that the principals of this board that we have pretty astute in saying to their staff, on this day or these days, you cannot park here. So I'm a little bit concerned that we only have one vendor, and I'd be more than happy to forward that vendor, or actually advise staff who the school is, and they can have a conversation, because the conversation that the principal had with supplier was, that's what it is. In other words, like it or not, I'm the only game in town. I've got the ball, or I'm going to go home with it, and you're not going to go home without it, which is a challenge, as you can appreciate. So if staff could arrange an evening, a virtual evening, that would be most appreciated. Right. I can go back to the back of the line as well.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and through you, I have two questions. My first question's regarding, we have term one report cards for elementary students that are going home soon, and parents are going to be scheduling interviews with their teachers coming up February 16th and 17th. And I'm hearing a few schools want to improve the way that the booking system for parents to be able to book in times to speak with their teachers. And they've apparently bought a license to an online booking system to help parents and staff. Is this something that, obviously we weren't aware of, is this something that individual schools are responsible for purchasing, or is this something that our board should maybe be looking into for a system like our Zoom licensing and whatnot? Because I think it from a functionality perspective and a convenience perspective, it helps with our parents being able to book in interview times and obviously coordinate when you have multiple children at the same school.
So through the chair, these have been ongoing discussions that we've been having through our ICT governance committee throughout the years. At this time, no decision has been made to implement such a product, and we can take that back to survey our schools to see what practices are going on out there.
Thank you. And through the chair, I just want to add, I would rather, instead of having individual schools doing their own things with different licenses and different purchases and different systems and softwares, my preference would be to have a system platform that would be equitable across the entire system for all parents, all schools, and similar to our school messenger system, for instance. We have all of the schools are combined. Obviously, that's a financial investment and coordinated efforts, but I do think that would be better across a system.
Through the chair, agreed.
Madam Chair, I have my second question. Would you like me? Thank you. I continue to hear that our secondary schools that I represent, and I don't think I'm unique, as Trustee Ionica likes to say, students vaping in the washrooms. And I believe I've brought this up before, but sometimes the schools would prefer to close the washrooms because they don't have the staff to manage them and deal with the issue. But these are there's a few concerns here. We have students arriving late to class because they can't find an open washroom. We have students that don't feel comfortable going into a washroom if there's a group of students vaping. We need clean, accessible, open washrooms throughout the day. And if I may ask staff to look into this issue, how can we address this issue? Because it's not just a single school issue, but it's a persistent issue. And I am concerned it has not improved. In fact, it's continuing to worsen. I do think there are some strategies and solutions that can be escalated to this level where we can come up with something that's a better option. What we might need more custodial staff. We might need a washroom monitor. There needs to be something done because it can't continue.
Through the chair, thank you for that. It's part of actual recent discussions we've had at Instructional Services Council with the family of school superintendents. We are aware of the issue and are hoping to come up with some recommended best practices moving forward.
Hello, through the chair. I was at a council meeting with St. Rita at St. Rita's, and there was a question asked regarding a secondary school in the Southfields area. So that's Mayfield and 10 area. Is there any thoughts to growing a secondary school in that area? Because I believe they're getting bused to Caledon East, to Robert F. Hall.
Through the chair, I believe that would be correct, that they would be bused to Robert F. Hall currently. When it comes to examining the possibility of looking at whether there may be sufficient enrollment for a new school to warrant a new school, we look at future enrollment projections in various areas. So for example, in Southfields Village, which I believe currently has St. Evan, we would be looking to see if there are, over the next 10 years, which is what the Ministry of Education usually asks, or we would be looking to see if there's sufficient future enrollment growth to be able to warrant the need to request a new school, new secondary school. But we'd also be looking at what the impact is on our existing schools. So for example, if there were growth in a certain area, but it comes kind of at the expense of one of our existing schools, it might make it a challenge because the Ministry of Education would say, Dufferin Peel, you've got existing capacity at a nearby school. Just use that capacity. Why would we as the ministry want to invest millions of dollars in new capital funding when you already have sufficient capacity at an existing one of your schools? So those are the kinds of discussions that they would contemplate if we were to go down that path. And it's the same for any new growth area. We always have to balance the consideration around what the future enrollment growth in that area is against what is the available capacity at our existing nearby schools.
So another question would be, so for the graduating class of St. Evans, everybody will go off to secondary at Robert F. Hall, is that correct? Or do they have the option of going to perhaps Cardinal Leger or any of the Brampton Catholic schools?
Through the chair, generally speaking, they would go to their nearest school in their catchment area, but they could also be, depending on, you know, if there's a particular program of interest and subject to available capacity, they may wish to consider a different school as well.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
See Herman Deloria.
Thank you, Madam Chair. My question is regarding executive compensation. You mentioned that in your report. I was reading that part. I have a question regarding that. As trustee associations and other education stakeholders at a number of years ago, the previous government, it would have been a liberal government, create a framework that would lead to a fair, stable, and transparent executive compensation program for a 3-year phase-in period. However, the implementation of the program did not roll out in a fair, equitable, or consistent manner. Example, there are 3 bullets. Some board plans were approved by the then Ministry of Education, did not follow the regulatory requirement. That had been the liberal government. Then the second bullet, some boards that had not requested a change in the specific levels of compensation were informed by the Ministry of Education that they needed to resubmit plans, thereby increasing their compensation level. Then the third bullet, some boards were allowed to move up 2 levels within the salary grids outside the approved regulatory requirements. So in view of all of these boards, some boards doing this and some boards doing that, what is our status as the board?
Through the chair, it's not an encampment. In regards to Dufferin Peel, Trustee Valoria, this board of trustees, I believe in 2016, in compliance with the executive compensation guidelines with the Ministry of Education, developed, publicly consulted, and submitted a plan to the Ministry of Education that was approved. So it was in complete alignment to those guidelines. It was intended to be a 3-year plan. The first year rolled out. You would recall then that in the summer or just the spring of that first year, there was a change in provincial government. And about
Liberals?
Correct, from the Liberals to the Conservatives, and about a week before the second year of the plan was to roll out, there was a freeze imposed. So, and that freeze has been in existence ever since.
So is it frozen for Dufferin Peel?
Through the chair, it is frozen for all 72 boards in the province.
But that would mean all of the levels from the director down to the superintendent?
The grids were frozen. It was intended to be a 3-year plan. The Board of Trustees developed a program for all executives, which was intended to move through 3 years.
It was compliant with the Liberal government's guidelines. It was approved by the government. The first year was implemented, but then it was frozen by the government that took over. And it that's correct. And it has not, there has not been any movement at all for any executives in Dufferin.
So I'm understanding this correctly, was the compensation ever unfrozen and used?
Through the chair, it has not been unfrozen. And while other occupational groups have seen annual increases to their salaries, executives have not seen anything since it's been frozen.
And this is for all the boards, because it mentions that some boards are not following ministry regulations and so on.
Through the chair, I can't speak for other boards, and I don't want to speak for other boards, but I can reiterate that this board has been compliant and has been compliant with the freeze.
As far as the Dufferin Bill is concerned, the whole grid is frozen.
Through the chair, yes.
From 2018?
2018.
Prior to 2018, was there movement?
Through the chair, no.
I'm just trying to make sure that...
Through the chair, there's been various regulations that have been brought in place for executives over the years. I want to say that it's probably been, save and except for that 2017 year, it's been more than 10 years since any kind of salary increase has been... given to executives, again, while other occupational groups saw annual increase.
That is why OXTA has made this recommendation.
Through the chair, that's correct.
This would allow superintendents, directors of education, and other executives included in the framework to be paid at the minimum of their board level. Been asked a question regarding violence in school. I've asked around, and apparently there is the ministry has sent someone to check with some schools. Is that correct?
Through the chair, I'm going to defer that question to Superintendent Strong.
It's a long name. Through the chair, the Ministry of Labor frequently undergoes blitzes across certain sectors. Here. Usually it's not a problem. I don't want to do that. Is that better? Okay. No. Through the chair, the Ministry of Labor is conducting a workplace violence blitz. So this will be targeting all school boards in the education sector. We've recently met with the Ministry of Labor. It was actually today. And these are compliance audits. So what the ministry does is they come in and they will give you a rough estimate of the amount of schools that will be visited. Sometimes they will give us the name of the school, sometimes they won't. A Ministry of Labor inspector will arrive at the school. They will conduct what is just compliance audits. Does the staff know where the policies are? Do they know how to follow the complaints procedure? Do they know how to access the resources? So this audit will be going on for the month of February and should end shortly in mid-March.
Would this be in connection with safety of workers?
Through the chair, it actually follows the OSHA guidelines and regulations under OSHA with regard to workplace violence in all occupations. So we'll be looking at violence, harassment, and discrimination.
Thank you, Madam Chair. If I am next, thank you. Through Madam Chair, regarding issues and events from last week, I noticed that the, let me just pull it up here again. Our service provider, cafeteria service provider is still having issues trying to keep staff or having challenges with staff recruitment and retention. My question is, why is Father Michael Gates getting full service when they have a plaza right across the street and the cafeteria service provider is not redeploying other staff, St. Augustine, Notre Dame, and Holy Name, when they only have one restaurant? I was looking out on Google here, one restaurant at between 450 to 650 meters away, when there's a full plaza right across the street from Gates.
So through Madam Chair, when we set up a plan with the vendor this past year, taking into consideration kind of a startup from COVID from last year, with the goal of trying to roll out as much service as we can amongst all schools, we did take into consideration as many operating factors as possible, including some of the demographics, location, size of school. So some of those may have competing factors around them. We're aware that some have plaza, some don't. Some of the more northern schools have a lot less competition. So all those are kind of taken into consideration, as well as some of the feedback from the principals themselves about what they wanted to have in a school and any feedback they had from their communities as well. So the goal would always be to have as much service as possible within all schools. But we had to recognize that with the provider and the limitations in getting staff and trying to roll out service to all schools in 1 year, there were limitations on that. So we started with getting as many schools up and running as possible with the full service. And then the grab and go was kind of the secondary option to that.
So can you just clarify? The service provider provided us with a list of schools back in September 2022, obviously, at the beginning. They already proposed, you know, tier levels 1, 2, and 3. I'm looking at it right here. St. Augustine was supposed to be a full service cafeteria, limited months, October to April. Holy Name was supposed to be the same. Notre Dame was supposed to be grab and go. And as of now, February, we still do not have full service at Holy Name in St. Augustine. So who created this list, us or them?
So through the chair, it was a collaborative effort. So looking at the successes and the challenges we had in the past year at the schools we were able to open, we put a plan forward and we shared ideas back and forth and where we thought the needs and where we could possibly get the services available to us. Obviously, we're still having challenges with the vendor obtaining staff. That is the number one challenge, is trying to recruit staff, train staff, and even maintain them. A lot of that is due to just the rates of compensation for the workers and the challenges in the labor market itself. As you pointed out, we had a plan that we'd come up with, and we did make changes to the suggestions the vendor did have, saying, no, we want some schools to have a different level of priority. But we did make it the best agreed upon model to be a success. We didn't want to have failures out there, have expectations set. Clearly, as you pointed out, Trustee Stefano, that we were not able to meet the obligations of what we originally set out, and we're still trying to adapt the best we can with the limitations we have with the provider and with that the market is providing for labor currently.
So what I'm hearing is that we're taking fault for a service provider in inability to staff their own locations, which they provided us and agreed to this list. I've used this saying before. It's not our problem that they can't staff things properly. So our students are now being penalized for not having food. Like what's happening now at Notre Dame or at St. Augustine or at Holy Name? It's February 6th, they're gonna start up. January 9th, what was the first day of school? January 9th? What's happened since January 9th to now, and actually from back in when they were supposed to give it to us? Like our students have to walk 1.5 kilometers to the nearest restaurant.
So through the chair, we definitely understand and hear your feedback. We have weekly calls with the provider, trying to understand the challenges that are there. Obviously, you know, it's out of the control that we have, but we make it very well known to them that this is the expectation that our goal was to have some kind of service at all schools. But unfortunately, with the challenges in general labor, which we've heard within food industry in general, and other service industries as well, where you see the signs on local restaurants and whatnot saying that labor is just a challenge in certain wage brackets. So it's, you know, we wish that we could have that service for all of our students, but we're doing the best working with the vendor to even maintain the current service we have. We've heard there's challenges with some of the current schools we've had open, and some of those individuals have wanted to leave the market or, you know, take other higher paying jobs. So they've had to struggle to even shift around to maintain the service at some of the existing schools. So that has delayed some of the rollout of trying to open up some of these newer schools. The one point I would like to make is, as this is the final year of the contract, we're looking at really the change in the landscape and what a cafeteria is and how that will look within the next, you know, two to five years, and take all that into consideration for our next request for proposals. So these are all lessons coming from COVID, as well as just the change in how food operations are now, with many more modes for delivery of food services coming into schools, with changing habits of families and what they want to do with food, or how they provide their students with food on a daily basis, and really what a cafeteria looks like in a school. And not that it makes us any better, but we are hearing challenges from other boards that didn't even open cafeterias even this current year. And we're hearing that some of them will never open again. So we're making sure that our goal for this RFP is to make sure that we get some level of service in our cafeterias. We want to have something there for our students, because we do recognize the benefits of having food in our schools, and the gathering place, and the healthy options where we can, that we can provide to them. But it is not going to be the same as what we've had in the past. That's what we're seeing across the province.
I appreciate the effort that we're putting forward to give our kids, our students, an option without going outside. But as what I'm seeing here is a service provider that is always providing us with an excuse as to why they can't open up something at a certain time. This is agreed to proposal that was given to us. Yes, there has been some changes. But, you know, back to what I was saying, Father Michael Gates, which is one of the schools that I represent with a couple of trustees on this board, is having full service when they have literally a plaza right across the street with over 10 restaurants. When you have your other schools, which are going to have grab and go, that have one restaurant between 450 and 650 meters away, and the other ones are over a kilometer away. I know that we were looking at, you know, feasibility, closeness to other food options in the area. And I, you know, there's other schools obviously that have like just a restaurant, sorry, just a gas station. But I think this, whatever's happened is we've changed the way that we're picking these schools, either our service provider or ourselves. And it's not because of closeness of food anymore. It's more of work and make the big bucks. So I'd like to see these schools hopefully be open by February 6th. But the issue also, again, is grab and go to a place that only has one location close by to them. Just isn't right for our students to have options. So I appreciate, thank you very much for the answer. Madam Chair, just one more question, if you mind. I'll bring this up again regarding MPAC. I know I didn't ask you guys before, but have we made any headway of them coming out and explaining how they create our lists?
Sure. Through the chair, there's been no headway yet. They're a difficult group to get out and commit to meeting with trustees.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Mr. Bruno, Anika.
Madam Chair, I have three questions, if I may. One of them, the first one is a little bit lengthy, but I will try to just pull out specific words. that will hopefully relay the message. I had a call from a parent, and he advised that he received an email from the school, but the email was from the region of Peel, because they have a child in grade 8. The email stated, tomorrow is our immunization clinic for grade 7 and 8 students. A reminder that an appointment must be made using the link in the attachment in order for your child to have their immunization tomorrow at the school clinic. So in other words, click, make an appointment, and you're done. The email would suggest, according to the parent, that if he or a parent, a guardian, would not like his child to participate in immunization at the school, he should simply not make an appointment. And he says that wasn't the case. Because when he got home on the evening, his grade 8 daughter told him that she was instructed by both the principal and the head nurse at the clinic line up for information about the immunizations. They lined up all grade 7 and 8 children to receive a consultation with the intention for students to call their parents to encourage their consent over the phone to get the shots. Nowhere in the correspondence sent to him stated that Peel Health would call down students that were not participating. I know the gentleman. I can tell you that he was very calm, very cool, very collective. He was extremely unhappy, extremely unhappy. The process is very clear. A reminder, an appointment must be made using the link in order for your child to have their immunization tomorrow at the school. You don't make the appointment, you don't get the immunization. You don't get called down and get, I won't say drilled, but for all intents and purposes, for grade 7, grade 8, and be told, these are the benefits of doing it. Now call your parents and put pressure on them. Unacceptable. Sorry, unacceptable. Can we look into the process and ensure that our principals and Dufferin Peel run our schools, not Peel Health? It's great to have Peel Health as a partner, no argument, but to go down this path and doing it this way is totally unacceptable.
Through the chair, the situation as you described, I would use your words as well, Trustee Ionica, that is unacceptable, and we intend to follow up tomorrow.
My next question, Madam Chair, elementary voice, over the years, and I know that we've come out of COVID, and the time that we spent with COVID, but over the years we've been advised that the secondary school elected to the student senate bring forth the concerns of elementary panel. All feeder schools would direct them to one point of contact, which would be the receiving school would have all of the feeder schools, all of those questions go into the one. It's been a while. Can staff advise where we are with that?
Yes, thank you, Trustee Ionica. It would be our intent to continue to work through the Student Voice Council to develop an articulated process. But for now, we intend to send the pictures and bios of our student trustees to all the elementary principals and have them share them with their faith ambassadors and student parliaments and create a structure for them to share an avenue for them to share their concerns with the student trustees.
Perfect. And Madam Chair, my next question, I have two more, but I'll answer one and wait for others. I'll ask one and wait for others. How do we let our teachers and students know if there is a hole in secure at our school?
So through the chair, the principal would get on the PA and say, initiate hold and secure. And then a sign would be placed on the door as well for any visitors that might be attempting to get in.
So if I'm a principal, and I'm in my office, and the PA is where Bruce is, maybe a little, say, closer, and somebody comes into the school, I've got to be a quick rabbit to get from over here to over there and make that announcement.
Through the chair, most principals have the ability to page from the phones in their office as well.
They do?
Through the chair, I believe so, yes.
Well, yeah. I'll ask the question, Trustee Stefano Pascucci, most or all?
Through the chair, I don't want to unequivocally say all. I haven't been in every school, but I would imagine that they all have that ability. I can take that back and confirm.
Can we have a look at what every school has and make sure that it's all equal? Is it, if some can do it by phone, and some have to, I don't want to use the words I wanted, but some have to dodge get there, then, you know, it makes it a little bit of a challenge. So I'll leave that with staff if you could, and maybe whenever choose an event. I'll wait for the next round, Madam Chair.
You have one more question.
I have one more.
Why did you finish that one?
I received an email this afternoon from a parent asking about fully remote. I'll paraphrase, fully remote learning for the next school year. And if possible, they would prefer if they could commit on a term by term basis instead of having to commit the entire school year to either in-person or fully remote learning mode.
Through the chair, we're still awaiting information from the ministry on whether or not it's going to be a directive to offer remote only classes or courses next year. We were assured last week at a CODE and an OXTA meeting, the ministry has indicated that decision should be coming shortly. Once we have an understanding of what our obligations are, then we will act accordingly.
Thank you, Madam Director. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Trustee Paul, is it about the?
Yes. Through the chair, thank you. I wanted to address what Bruno just spoke about with the online term for the next year. I also received an email from a constituent asking the same thing, if they could go term by term, and also Trustee Anisha. Everybody, we've all received the same request. So I would suggest that the constituents are looking for online, and they're looking for term by term.
Through the chair, it would be our intent to survey the system and the parents to get an indication if we are to offer remote only classes or courses next year, to get an indication of the interest in that. And that could be part of the survey that we send out, is exploring whether or not they want to go term by term or semester by semester, and then investigating the impact or the implications of being able to offer that flexibility.
Perfect, thank you.
Please step in.
Thank you, Mentor. Actually, it was to Trustee Anika's second question, if you want to call it, but I can wait until the end and I can just my piece after. Thank you.
Trustee Herman Deloria.
This one is a follow-up to Trustee Stefano regarding the cafeteria. My question is to the chair, is there no performance clause in that contract with the provider that if they're unable to perform they were contracted for, that they were in breach, we can get someone else instead?
So through the chair, there are typically service standards or contractual kind of obligations for us and for the service provider. But with the past couple of years of COVID, we've kind of had to set aside many of the terms of that to basically do what we can do to open cafeterias and to get as many opens as we have. As I mentioned, other boards didn't open any or haven't opened any to this point, or are just starting to make those considerations. So service standards we've not been able to hold to the full terms that we originally started almost 5 years ago. just due to the challenges we've had. So we've kind of had to start from zero and kind of work our way back to the best we can, recognizing the environment and the challenges we're in right now. Some of the challenges have been raised this evening and some of those service standards. That's all part of the request for proposals that we put out. Considering one vendor versus many vendors, that will open up, I think, different options. So my previous comment about the previous landscape, what a cafeteria may look like in a secondary school, won't be the same for this next round. So, you know, all options are being considered for enhancing the service that is provided from our vendors to our schools and our students.
Thank you. And to my question, years ago, McCarthy's, who is the sole provider for uniforms, used to give commissions to the various schools. That practice ended, and apparently it was the rationale behind it, and I'm not sure whether I heard correctly, was rather than benefiting the school and sort of making money over the students who are buying the uniform, why not make lower the price of the uniform and give no commission? Is that correct?
Through the chair, that's correct. That was something that was worked through with the Board of Trustees. The rationale was that as a Catholic school system, we are obligating secondary students to wear a uniform. There's no choice. And therefore, it was more important to ensure that it was as cost effective as possible for parents.
So has anyone monitored the prices did go down?
The chair, can you clarify? You mean the prices of McCarthy's?
In lieu of a commission, right. McCarthy's was supposed to lower the prices of uniforms. Anyone check that they did?
So I'm going to defer to Superintendent Brian Hester to respond.
So through the chair, when that last contract ended, it actually ended due to the bankruptcy of a previous vendor. And then McCarthy's was resurrected as a new business, essentially, and they won that latest contract. Prices were locked in at the point in time. However, it's basically impossible to prove whether or not a rebate, reducing the rebate or eliminating the rebate, was fully factored in by the vendor, because the vendors submit their bids, but they don't show the components of what make up the price for whatever those garments are. So we have to have trust in the vendors as a request for proposal, putting their best cost forward with the quality standards, the fair labor practices and whatnot, all built into that, to that procurement that was released to the system.
That's very difficult to police, but then if the principal is not to make money over what students pay for, uniform and food to the cafeteria, and the provider in this case also provides a commission, then we should be consistent then, and no one provides any commission.
So through the chair, it's something like a commission is called a value add. So we don't ask for a commission when they respond to a bid. It would be up to a vendor to decide what's a value add to their proposal to the board. Some of them might add in a commission and some of them may not. Having a commission would be a very low priority, but it's also something that we could consider as not being part of it. But again, there is quite a difference between the uniform and the cafeteria. The uniform, as mentioned by our director, we require our students to wear a uniform. They are obliged while attending our schools to wear a uniform. Cafeteria services are optional. Students do not have to use the cafeteria. So there is a bit of a difference between both of those types of vendors working in our schools.
Will not pursue the matter then. But the principle is that making money over students' expenses, whether it's required or not, whether you have to buy a uniform or you're not, and it's optional to buy food. The principle is that if the principle is not to make money over the students pay for, then it should be quite consistently, but that's
not the chair. We can take that back, Trustee Ballard.
Not the principal. It would be Stevie. Just to be clear.
Through the chair, I believe Trustee Valoria was talking about principal as in L-E, not in principal as in A-L.
To be clear.
Trustee Paula. Hi, I just, through the chair, I wanted to make another suggestion or comment about cafeterias. So I know Robert F. Hall, I think, just ended a contract with their cafeteria, I believe, maybe not. But my suggestion would be, is there any way we can get a local chef or a local vendor to take over the cafeteria as a contract and just resource, like use our local resources, I'm sure, and run it as a business? And that would be a great opportunity because, you know, during COVID, we learned how to shop local and those kind of things. So instead of always going to a agency or, you know, a big corporation, I'm just wondering if we can source out some local talent to run our cafeterias.
Through the chair, as referenced, the contract is up this year, and all of these possibilities are on the table.
Perfect. Thank you.
Seeing none, we're moving on to declared interest item. So we do have a declared interest item, agenda item A7, L1, L2, L3. Could I have a mover, please? Moved by Trustee Thomas, seconded by Trustee Daryl D'Souza. It's on the phone. All in favor? Carried. Thank you. So we need to have them back, please. Okay. So, next item in the agenda, Madam Director, next item in the agenda is an in-camera session.
Through the chair, motion to move in camera.
Motion to move in camera, moved by Trustee Stefano Pascucci, seconded by Trustee Anisha Thomas. All in favor? So we're going to
have a break at 10:30.
Yes, so we're going to break for until 10:30. To the people watching on YouTube.
Madam Chair, before we break, I should forget it after.
Okay, go ahead.
No, can we move a motion to finish the agenda because it is 10:30?
We will, as soon as we go back into the camera. So to the person, to the people watching on YouTube, the Board of Trustees are moving into in-camera session. Thank you, and you can stand by.
December 13, 2022. Approval of in-camera minutes of special board meeting January 17, 2023. Then minutes of in-camera session of administration and finance committee meeting November 8, 2022. Minutes of in-camera session of the faith and program committee meeting October 11, 2022. Minutes of in-camera session of contract negotiation committee meeting December 13, 2022. Then advocacy group verbal report. Then two in-camera clear items in minutes of in-camera session of regular board meeting December 13, 2022, and minutes of in-camera session of special board meeting January 17, 2022, item M5A.
Madam Director, do we need to have it approved, received, the in-camera? No, doesn't happen. Thank you. So our future meeting is on February 28, 2023. Could I get somebody move adjourned? Moved by Trustee Bruno Enica. Seconded.
Daryl.
Oh, seconded by Daryl. All in favor?
All right.
Good night, everyone.
Good night.